Okay, folks, it's gone time, so we'll start. Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2015 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, electronic devices, etc. Our first item of business is to take evidence on the Scottish rate of income tax as part of our scrutiny of draft budget 2016-17. We'll hear from two separate sets of witnesses today. And first, I'd like to welcome to the meeting Ben Thomson and Lucy Hunter Blackburn. Members have received copies of a briefing note by the Budget Advisor, along with written evidence submitted by our witnesses, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. So welcome to you both this morning. Ben, you've been to the committee on a number of occasions, so it's good to have you back. I don't think you've been here before, have you, Lucy? No. Well, welcome to the Finance Committee. So what I'm going to do is I'll just ask you some opening questions, of course, and then we'll go around the table for colleagues to ask questions. So I might ask you to comment on each other's submission because they're both kind of diametrically, well, not diametrically opposed, but they are significantly different. And so we'll have a wee look at how you each respond to each other's as well as how the committee responds. So first of all, Ben, I mean, you're talking in your submission, you're suggesting, and first of all, I'm pleased that you've actually made concrete suggestions because many of the people who've given us evidence kind of shied away from that, I have to say. So at least you have made suggestions, whether the committee agrees with them or whether the Scottish Government ultimately does or not, is a we'll soon find out. But you, Ben, have suggested a 2% reduction would reduce the tax burden on all Scottish income taxpayers by £660 million. So when I thought of that, I'm thinking, oh, well, how are we going to actually have to make the reductions in spend, etc., to fund that? But then you go on to suggest that that could be raised, in actual fact, that £660 million, by raising the council tax by an average of 33%, which seems to me a fairly whopping rise. I'm just wondering if you can talk us through your thinking on that.
On which bit of it?
On the balance between reducing Scottish rate of income tax by 2 pence in the pound and correspondingly raising council tax by 33% in order to compensate for that, so there's no effective loss to the Scottish Government in terms of revenue.
Sure. I mean, the thinking behind it is, first of all, it would be a great disappointment having spent so much of my time over the last 6 years arguing that different levels of government should have fiscal responsibility if all Scottish Government and the committees and powers within the Parliament did was mirror what happens in the rest of the UK. It seems an immense opportunity to actually do something with the taxes that we have and use them to provide a better tax service. After all, a tax service is only raising revenues to create good public services. So the suggestion to actually reduce tax, which I suspect you haven't had many submissions to reduce the rate of tax, is, first of all, it would, I think, give a really good message that you're doing something positively. Secondly, and this may be where Lucy and I disagree a bit, Lucy would see it as a progressive tax. I would say it would be much more progressive if we were allowed to vary the bands, which will happen potentially later once the effects of the Calmon Commission come in. But at this stage, it's a very the 10p rate is across all bands, so it's quite an inflexible tax. And if you look at it as a percentage of how much tax increases, actually, it will hit the people on lower taxes as a percentage of the total tax that they pay than on higher rates, though actually higher rates will pay, in absolute terms, more. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that there will be a choice in the next few years for a percentage of people to decide where they want to pay their taxes. And I know the rules are being devised on this, but actually having a slightly lower tax will encourage people to see being designated as a Scottish resident and actually deciding they want to pay tax in Scotland. If the Scottish rate of income tax were to go up, if you were proposing a change, it may actually push some people, where they have the choice, to decide to pay their tax south of the border rather than north of the border. But lastly, I think the reason I'm suggesting a reduction is it sends out a fantastic message that Scotland's open for business and that it's not all about let's have more and more taxes. So as I set out in the paper, a 2p reduction is by Treasury figures about 660 million. The Treasury is saying it's about 330 million per 1p of tax. John Kay, in a presentation a few months ago, was saying it's about 400 million. So, I mean, you've got your own economists who can do the numbers, but that seems to be about the ballpark figure. Obviously, these taxes, the public sector, then has to be funded. And there are a few things that I think Scotland could do with its taxation system that would actually make a lot more sense to replace the 660 million. The first is council tax is, and I think this is where Lucy and I would probably agree, is something of a guddle. We have had the bans in place since 1991. The bans actually don't make sense. For someone like myself, who is in a reasonably expensive property, we're paying the same as a banded person who was on 220,000 in 1991, and properties have changed significantly. It's a fairly regressive tax in that people who have wealth pay as a percentage of their property a lot less than people who are at the bottom end of the scale who are paying in band A. So that's the first thing about council tax that needs to be addressed, is the banding is a guddle. The second thing is the council tax freeze has distorted things. And I know it's a nice political policy to have the fact that you've frozen a tax, but actually it isn't a tax in a way. It just has to have been funded by the Scottish government. And it has taken away responsibility from local government. I was looking through all the statements of all five parties in the Scottish Parliament. All of them in the last 6 months have made reference to their commitment towards localism and passing powers down to a local level. This is a fantastic opportunity to actually do that and say, we're reducing the level of tax that Holyrood gets, and we're empowering and pushing down responsibility, more responsibilities for taxes at a local level. The analysis that has been done so far would suggest that the tax freeze alone, if it had been unfrozen since 2008 and allowed to grow with inflation, would be about £570 million. So that in itself pretty much offsets it. If you were then also to include the rebanding, then one could see, I think Retties have put forward a proposal that that would do about £750 million of additional revenue. So, you know, you can actually match the figure of the 2p cut with addressing the council tax. I'm not saying that council tax is the only tax you should potentially look at. I also think that you could look at some taxes that would change real behaviour in Scotland. And one that I have suggested before is a tax on sugar. Why don't we do things differently? We did things differently when it came to smoking, and actually people around the country, the whole of the UK, said well done. Sugar is now a major problem, and our NHS is suffering from a huge increase in diabetes. Perhaps looking at treating sugar in the same way that we treat tobacco, if we put the same rate of tax on sugar as we do on tobacco, we would be raising about £700 million. So I'm not saying council tax is the only way to do it. I'm really getting to the heart of this is, let's do some creative things with the tax powers that we've got, rather than just keep the Scottish rate of income tax exactly the same as it is south of the border.
Okay, well, thank you very, very much for that. One point you did make, you did suggest that, you know, that people who, with a lower SRIT, might help themselves to organise themselves to pay their income taxes in Scotland. And you touched on that there, and both in your submission. But in evidence we took previously from Professor Bailey, said that at this kind of level, it doesn't make any difference at all, really. That, you know, no one's going to decide to change their domicile effectively on the basis of a 2%. You know, tax rate or something like that. They might, if it's 10% of a differential, possibly 5%, but with 2 or 3%, there's no real evidence that it makes any difference in terms of deciding where one would reside.
I think there's no real evidence either way round, but I don't think it's this bit of tax that's going to make the difference. It's the whole attitude towards taxation. And what people are looking at is, when all the proposals come in on Calman, that is the point that we may be nervous about what's going to happen to major tax changes. And if you're sending the message now that the Scottish Government is going to be different and innovative and actually an exciting place to be, people are going to say, well, if all these tax changes are going to come and I'm going to have a choice, and people do have dual residences in south of the border, north of the border, I'll organise my affairs if I think that the taxation system in Scotland is going to be worse going forward than it is in England, to start having it in England. Because once you start residences in a particular place, it's then more difficult to change. So I suspect there'll be a number of people who, if you actually said, we're going to lower it, will take a decision. Look, if that, they're going to do that sort of attitude, that will flow through for later tax changes that may happen once we get greater powers after Calman.
Okay. Now, Lucy, you want to effectively put SRIT at 1.5% in order to effectively release money on spending on services, which you say has been taken out as a result of the council tax freeze, which you've said has created caused a hole to develop in the Scottish budget. Is a hole in the Scottish budget not really because the UK government's cut funding by 10% in real terms? Because you've talked about local government funding falling by about 10% in real terms. So.
Well, you're right, of course, that one of the big pressure facing the Scottish budget is what's coming through the Barnett formula, absolutely. But what, if you look at what's happening with the council tax freeze funding, that's £560 million that we are choosing to spend on the council tax freeze rather than on addressing the pressure created on the budget through the Barnett formula. So I suppose that's the point I really want to make, is that the council tax freeze costs money. It's a substantial spending commitment on the part of the Scottish Government, and it's crept up in time, and I don't think anyone, when it started, would have expected it to reach a point where it was costing something equivalent, say, the further education college system, and yet now it is. So why I was so pleased the committee put out this general call for evidence and let everybody, people like myself, put in our views, is it's a chance really not to challenge, say, whether we have the council tax freeze, but how we fund it and to see the connection. And what I wanted to do was to really invite the committee to see a connection between the new powers available through the Scottish rate and the funding of the council tax freeze. So that's really the point I want to make. But of course, you're right. It's the pressures on the block are large. And that's really why I think it's important we look again at how we use these powers.
And quite frankly, the reason why I invited you to come along this morning is because you're probably the most interesting of all the submissions we've received,
it's
actually. And I think
me,
it's important that we do actually have some, and no offence to yourself, Ben, but I have to say that, you know, it is good to have some kind of challenging pieces of evidence like this. I really, really enjoyed reading your submission. One of the things, though, you point out, though, that you talk about, you know, people at higher bands obviously saving more through council tax freeze, which is absolutely true, obviously. But as a proportion of their income, who saves the most?
Well, that's interesting, because council tax, you can't map it back to income exactly. It's a crude thing. You look at the scale of properties. What we do know is that the very poorest people save nothing from the freeze, because the council tax reduction scheme saves means that there is no council tax payable. It's a zero effect. So I was trying to sort of see if I could find a sort of simple way of summarising what's happening there, because it's a complex set of data. But we do know that there's one in five households are in the council tax reduction scheme. So that's a large number of low-income households. We know that 15% of the potential tax take from the council tax is met through council tax reduction, because the Scottish Government took the view when council tax benefit was abolished that it was going to maintain a low-income safety net. So we know for sure the easiest bit on income is we know the very poorest save nothing. The council tax reduction also seems, I know not everyone gets 100%, but if you look at the sort of saving, it's about £660 per household as an average on some statistics that came out just this week. So that suggests that if you're getting a council tax reduction, you're probably getting either 100% or a very high percentage. So we know that the very lowest incomes haven't really been affected either way. You're right, I think. I'm sure if you could do the numbers, if the data was there, and I'm not sure it's been published, you, as a proportion of income, absolutely, the kind of savings on council tax are probably going to be higher for low earners, people above the council tax reduction, absolutely. I suppose my point would be that's £560 million that we are spending in a way which gives proportionately out of income a bit more to the poorest, but it still means that over half of that benefit, over half of that 560, is going into higher band properties, so band D and above. probably rather more than half it. You can't quite do the sums precisely. So it's not really a question about whether the council tax freeze is or isn't progressive, although I think given the council tax reduction, it's only progressive in a limited, you know, for a limited group of the population. It's really whether that 560 could be spent more progressively than on the council tax freeze. And I think if my arguments would be that if you look at the way that public spending cuts have fallen, and we'll maybe come back to that, there is a better use for that 560. The 560 is effectively being paid for disproportionately by people who don't benefit from it in the same way.
Okay, so we'll take on board a wee minute about spending progressively, but in terms of the effect on people's income, I mean, one of the things Ben put in his submission, of course, was that when you increase taxation, you know, by whether it's 2%, 3%, 1.5%, you're suggesting across the board, as a proportion of people's incomes, lower paid people effectively on the margins will be the ones that were most adversely impacted. Right. So if they're getting a disproportionate saving in terms of council tax freeze because it's a higher proportion of income, but you're suggesting they would pay a higher proportion, of their income because they're paying this extra 1.5. That seems to me the opposite of what you're suggesting in terms of progressive taxation, well, at least.
Yeah, I think
even if the spend is more progressive, terms of the income distribution.
This is where I differ with Ben on the progressive regressive argument. It's a really, really important point, and I'm conscious the committee will want to take a view on it. Where Ben is looking at, when he talks about the impact by income, he's looking at how much your tax goes up. So your tax you will pay, it is absolutely right to say that under the Scottish rate, you'll pay your tax as a percentage of your existing tax, the extra penny will be more at lower incomes. Mm-hmm. But what that argument doesn't pick up is that at lower incomes, you pay much less of your income as tax, full stop. And when you run, there's an immensely useful calculator that the committee had put on its site, which is hugely helpful. Mm-hmm. I want to just commend whoever's idea that was, because it's really helpful. When you run the figures through, and you can see it in my submission, I put some numbers in. When you look at the tax increase as a proportion of all income, not as a proportion of the tax you already pay, then it's the Scottish rate is progressive. It increases the proportion of income that you pay as tax. You put a penny on everyone's income tax above 10,000 roughly, you will pay a larger share of your income as tax because you pay more of your income as tax generally. So it is progressive, and you see that actually the NHS submission very helpfully made the point that raising the Scottish rate would be a very slight, not huge, but a very slight narrowing of income inequality. That doesn't make sense unless it fits.
Okay, fine. I mean, okay. Ben, you might want to come back on that at all, no?
I agree with the analysis that's been done. I think it would be fair to say that people's wealth is basically made up of both their income and the wealth that's mostly held in property. And the two aren't necessarily the same. You can have people who have high levels of income but low levels of property wealth and vice versa. So you can't quite equate the two, which I think is where you're trying to get to, Kenneth. But if you look at council tax, those at the bottom bands are paying approximately 1% of their value of their property each year in rates because of the way the banding works. Whereas if you're at the bottom of the higher bands, you're paying about 0.3% of the property. So in terms of income tax, we're all happy with that people should pay a higher percentage as you get more income tax. Whereas exactly the same, exactly the opposite argument seems to happen at council tax. So my point is, look, if Scotland really wants to start having some interesting discussions on tax, let's be brave and let's address these things and let's actually look at council tax for the guddle that it is and say let's do it properly. Let's actually use the opportunity that we have now to do something with it. And I think both Lucy and I agree that this is the opportunity. The last thing I'd say on Lucy's submission is I've actually made my submission on the basis, which is I think what the committee asked for, is if you're having a reduction or an increase in tax, can you just let me know how you're going to match that? I'm not making any statements about whether we should overall tax take should be higher or lower, because that's a slightly different argument. And I think Lucy might be making more of an argument for we need more tax revenue anyway to pay for more public sector costs. And my arguments are really not looking at that particular question, because I felt that wasn't what the committee was asking for this particular meeting.
Okay, no, we were looking for people to make all sorts of suggestions, increasing, lowering, maintaining spending and taxes. Back to yourself, Lucy. I mean, in terms of council taxes, so you're in favour of abolishing council tax freeze. What would that be? What kind of impact would that have? I mean, assuming it's funded by 1.5% increase in tax or whatever is required to meet that. So your view then is that council tax should just be allowed to rise as necessary, because obviously you'll be aware, having given your experience of the gearing effect, in terms of you know, a 1% rise in spending for a local authority can cause a, can mean a 5% increase in council tax, because it's 80-20 funded, more than that now, but for argument's sake.
Absolutely. Well, in fact, what I was doing with the submission, and that's maybe my fault for not being clear enough, I'm not arguing for the immediate cessation of the council tax freeze for exactly the reasons you give. You can't, it's too big. You can't possibly begin to ratchet back from where we are. So what I'm really arguing for is that we should go on funding the freeze. We should put the money on the Scottish rate. That generates the money. That then, so we then have 560-odd, more than we now have, which means we can plug the gap in the spending. The council tax freeze remains part of that picture in the short term, because it would cause a kind of crisis of legitimacy, I suspect, if you were to try and push up the council tax very quickly and sharply. What I would hope is that the current review of local taxation will come out with something substantial this autumn to which we can move, but it will take time to move. Local councils and local politicians don't want to suddenly find themselves confronted with issuing a 10%, 20% bill increase. And I don't think most people would find that a comfortable budgeting position. So what I'm really suggesting here is you see the Scottish rate as a bridge. We bring back in, we've lost £560 million of revenue, which we would have raised through the council tax. We bring it back in using income tax, which I would agree is fairer than the current council tax. And once you've got that space in your budget, you can then begin to transition. And perhaps over time, if you can move more, and Ben and I definitely agree here that you want to move, get out of this very acute gearing, push more tax raising back to the local level. And over time, in fact, in my model, you would bring the Scottish rate back down.
Okay. A couple of points. First of all, in terms of the additional funding that's going to, you know, tax isn't going to come from thin air, it's going to come from people's wages. The Scottish Retail Consortium in their submission have suggested that with retailing being fairly fragile at the moment, any increase in taxation would actually impact adversely on the money people have to spend in shops and businesses, and that itself would have an adverse impact on the Scottish economy. What's your view on that, either of you, both of you?
I think I agree with Sir. I don't think I have the expertise in that sort of macroeconomic side of things. I would absolutely, you know, the committee will have a chance and will have its own views on that. I don't bring that part of the debate to the party. I want really here to be the voice of the part of the argument which says we've got large public spending cuts across the political spectrum. There's concern about the impact of those at local and national level. So that's what I want to bring into this debate. But I would have to say I don't think I can bring an evidence-based response to that question.
Okay.
On that particular point, the proposals that I'm putting forward doesn't increase or decrease the overall cake. Yes. So, and the public has got to pay for it in the end. So the money is coming from the public. It doesn't make them richer or poorer. It just, it may redistribute it amongst different people. But I think what is important is the messages that you give, and the public particularly look at headline rates. Income tax is one that they always look at, incredibly important, and it's about public confidence. You can't measure public confidence particularly, but if you come out with a headline rate such as income tax actually being reduced, it gives people a real confidence that you're confident about the future going ahead, even though the tax actually, in the end, will be paid by the public because we're raising the same amount of the tax take under my proposals.
Okay, I've got a lot of colleagues want to come in, and I don't want to kind of, you know, ask much more because I need to give other people a chance. But Lucy, in terms of your potential areas of spending, you've suggested on local services and student grants, and you're effectively saying that any increase in taxation, that's where it should go. But one might think that's because you've got a history or a vested interest. One might say in that area you were head of local government finance distribution at the Scottish office and then head of higher education, the Scottish executive. So one might suggest that's because of your background there, which is why perhaps you haven't suggested, for example, the NHS, justice, whatever it happens to be. So I just wonder if you can comment on that.
I should say I did work in the Justice Department in Historic Scotland, and they may be rather hacked off that I didn't mention them either. Yeah. No, I mean, I speak well of what I know. I mean, absolutely. I think what I do think is that in fact, although I grants is what I know, so I want to put the evidence in front of the committee that if you're on a household income of below 17,000, and you have a student in full-time education, you've lost £900 a year in student grant in the last 2 years. So that's a substantial cut in household. Now, you can borrow. Perhaps it's important to say students can borrow that to fill that gap, but that's just tax they're going to pay in the future, effectively. So I want to make the point about grants because I know it. But actually, local government is the one I'd like to press more, because it was very interesting. Spice came up with an immensely helpful note yesterday about the council tax and funding of councils. And what I picked up from that was that in the last 7 years, even though the council tax freeze itself is funded, the actual that bit is the right size for the job it's doing. Spice quite clearly say that.
Well, they said it was overfunded.
Well, they said absolutely. They said it was overfunded. Yes, it's been overfunded over the period. So if you look at 2010, 2011, there were years when it was overfunded, absolutely. In the current financial year, there's a £4 million gap, which is de minimis, I guess I would say. So 560 is about right for where council tax would have been, as Ben was saying, had we increased it by RPI. But at the same time, they identified a £756 million real terms fall in the grant, the total grant provided to local government. So I think local government's very much the case. And in fact, I spent last night doing a bit of catching up on where are we now with what we know about local government budgets. And the Joseph Rowntree Foundation said 2 years ago that the reductions in local government grant were £90 a head higher in the most disadvantaged areas than the most advantaged. I spent a bit of time going through Edinburgh's budget documents for the last year, and I won't dwell on them now, but there's endless examples there of where there's salami slicing, I guess is the phrase, of services for vulnerable families. And that's, I think, in a council which did a very good job, big public consultation on its budget last year. It's an SNP Labour coalition. It sits outside a lot of the conventional political debate in Scotland. And as a parent in Edinburgh, I would say they did a good job on their budget consultation. I don't get any sense they took these decisions lightly. So I would actually urge the committee, if I was going to look anywhere across, it's local government, and because that's where the most vulnerable families and young people and old people are supported most, and I think that's where the cuts probably need to be ameliorated most.
Okay, well, thank you for that. The first colleague to ask questions will be Joan, to be followed by Jean.
Hey, thanks, convener. I mean, probably to build on some of the things that have already been raised. I mean, this question of is this a progressive tax, SRIT, or is it a regressive tax? Can we just not answer that yes or no? Is it basically how you look at it?
Relative or absolute.
So you can make anything in absolute terms. People who pay more tax yes. will pay an absolute greater amount of tax, but as a percentage yes. of their total amount of tax, people at the lower end will pay a greater percentage. So the answer is it's dependent on relative or absolute.
Right.
Does that make sense?
So, therefore, it's really not possible for anyone to stand up and say this is a progressive tax or to say this is a regressive tax.
I would say it's a much more progressive tax than council tax at the moment, where right. in council tax terms, those at the bottom are paying a much higher percentage of the wealth of their properties than people at the top end.
Right. Ms. Blackburn, sorry.
May I put the counter-argument committee? It is a progressive tax. The technical definition of a regressive tax, I was checking this, is a tax which takes a higher proportion of the income at lower incomes, of your income, not your tax, but it takes a higher proportion of your income as you earn less. If you have, forgive me if I read this off my submission, but at £15,000, 1.5p on the SRIT will represent 0.5% of your post-tax income. It's paragraph 17 of my submission.
Yes.
At £125,000, the Scottish rate will represent 2.3% of your post-tax income, and it rises in a, not linear, but it rises in a straightforward fashion. So there is absolutely no contest. I'm going to have to disagree pretty strongly with Ben here, but I know he knows I'm going to say this, that it is a progressive tax. And as I say, there's the NHS submission very helpfully points out that raising SRIT would decrease income inequality. That would be the effect only of a progressive tax. A regressive tax couldn't have that effect. And they cite evidence, which I confess I've not read, from, I think it's Comerford and Bell and Eisner at Stirling University, which has done work on this. I have absolutely complete confidence in arguing that this is a progressive taxation.
Yes. The figure that actually struck me from your paragraph 17 table was that when you compare taxable income, 25,000 and 125,000, which is exactly five times,
yep.
You look at the tax and it's 216 up to 1875. So someone earning five times the salary is actually paying 8.5%. Sorry, 8.5 times the tax.
Yes.
And that struck me as pretty straightforward.
Absolutely. It's because, and it's very simple, the arithmetic is simple. If you just say 10,000 for simplicity's sake is what you don't get taxed on. If I have an income of 15,000, I'm taxed on only a third of my income. If I have an income of 100,000, I'm taxed on 90%. Yep. So you're going to get this effect.
If I can just give you the numbers.
Back again. If you look at the same numbers on 15,000, your total tax at the moment would be £800 at 15,000. With the increase by 1p, it'll go up to 924, which is a £44 increase. That's a 5% increase in your tax on income tax. If you look at 100,000, which I think is the same thing as the 120, I haven't got the 120 figure on me, but 100,000, you would be paying 29,400 of tax, and the additional amount would be 894, so your total tax will have gone up by 3%. So that's the difference between the relative
and
the
absolute.
Yes,
if you're basing it on the tax you're paying. No, I take that point. I mean, I suppose linked to that, somebody made the suggestion that because this, in one sense, is a temporary power that we have, and that hopefully we're going to get fuller powers over tax when we really can be seriously progressive, as I personally would like to be, then maybe we shouldn't be using it in the meantime. Do you think that's an argument?
Well, I think you should start as you mean to set on. If you want to be, if you want to set a message that you're going to do really interesting things with taxation, then start when you've got the powers. I think one of the big criticisms of the Scottish Government is it had 3p raising and lowering power for ages, never got used, and the public sort of said, well, you know, why do you want all these powers if you don't actually use them? Mm-hmm. We have differences in Scotland, and there are problems in our taxation system, that Scotland could actually lead the way and be seen as being really innovative. So why don't you grab those? It may not be council tax, though I think that does need to be changed. We both do. But there are other taxes that you could actually say, let's be innovative and actually
do
things
differently. Let's just stick to this tax at the moment. Ms. Blackburn, do you think we should... The temporary idea of this?
I can see why people make that argument. I mean, as a kind of former public servant, you like things tidy. I can see the tidiness of waiting, but it's a question of urgency. I think genuinely it's a question of urgency. So I was looking, for example, in Edinburgh, in 2015-16, they've reviewed the Family Solution Services to save £200,000, which means reducing the service by 10%. I think it's important to be concrete here about what's going on out there. 400 vulnerable families are currently supported by the service. The effect of reviewing that service, according to the report, it will have an impact on the number of families that can be supported, with the risk that this could lead to an increase in the number of looked-after children. And they will work more with high-tariff families to mitigate that effect. And if you look, Joseph Rowntree says you'll find this right across the local government world. It's not that the services are being absolutely killed, but they're being pulled back and targeted. So the people who are just on the edge of being vulnerable, actually some of the people we most need to, it would be most sensible to be going to help, are being lost. So I think it's an urgency question. I read the political debate about austerity, about public service cuts, as an urgent issue. And it's, there's a validity in the argument that says let's wait. And if we weren't living in the sort of times we're living in, I would think that would be a very sensible public administration point. I think the complex thing for politicians yourselves and those in government to balance is how far do those sort of technical admin arguments outweigh really what's happening and what we can see is going to be happening across budgets in very urgently next year.
I mean, that you bring in the kind of political side to this, and one of the things I'm thinking of is if we were to raise the tax by, say, a penny, how do we sell that to the public? Now, I'm not sure that giving more money to local government would be particularly grab them. Yep. I'm not sure that, I mean, you suggested, is it page 6, paragraph 20, that we could have a kind of bridge to save tax in future. I don't think that's going to grab them either, I'm afraid. Yep. But if we said it's for schools, teachers, GPs, would that grab them better, do you think?
I think you're more the experts than I am on what works in talking to a wider community. It is really important. SCVO talked about a conversation about tax, and you know I agree with them there. We need to talk about it. One thing I didn't say in the submission, but which I'm quite clear about, I can see it would be almost impossible for any single party to put this proposal forward on its own. That there are, if it's much more easily done if there's a coalition across those parties who are concerned about public spending cuts. To put a united front forward. I think there'll always be some legitimate voices in the debate, like Ben's, saying that there's other ways to think about this. But if there's a... I think as soon as it gets into the sort of the political debate and contest, it becomes harder again. So if you're going to sell this, I suspect it would have to be as something which more than one party signed up to.
Okay. Mr. Thomson, you said that you weren't pushing for an overall increase or decrease in the tax take, I think.
Yep.
But you also said that if we cut...
I think that's what the committee actually asked me to in their request. They said, if you're reducing the tax, how would you balance it with... how would you balance the book? So that's the question I've answered.
Ah, right, okay. Because you did say things like open for business, different, innovative, exciting, and boosting confidence, which all seemed linked to reducing income tax. Maybe yeah. I misunderstood that.
What I was saying is the message that you give out to people that, I mean, at the moment, the public probably thinks that the powers that are going to come down will result in higher taxation. I don't know if that's a true statement, but that seems to be the anecdotal evidence of when reading the papers, is that the likelihood is that it's either going to stay the same or taxes are going to go up. I think actually this is a huge opportunity to revamp taxes and the powers that come down. The argument is that you change the tax mix to actually make it more sensible throughout the system and also take on board some of the parties' comments, different parties' comments, about how the powers that are coming down to Holyrood should then be passed on down to local government and not necessarily stop at Holyrood. So it's a message that you're actually changing tax as much as you're just increasing the overall take or decreasing the overall take.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a danger we get too wide here, and you know, I'm keen that we try and keep a focus. But I mean, presumably, I mean, either way it sends a message, because if we take a penny off tax, people know that that, you know, the schools get a bit less money, the hospitals get a bit less money or something. If we put a penny on tax, we get slightly better schools, we get slightly better GPs.
Sure.
So both ways sends a message, don't they?
Oh, no, I totally agree with you. I think there is an argument to be made for increasing taxes, and I think that argument could be made by Lucy to say, look, this is what we could do with increasing taxes. I've actually put an argument, a counter-argument to that, to say, wouldn't it be refreshing if the first thing you did with the Scottish income tax rate is to decrease it and use it to do two things. One is to give more empowerment to local government, and the second is to sort out some of the other taxes that actually would make a better tax mix. So I think there is I would much rather see the tax go up or down than stay the same, because I think it sends out a message that this Parliament is actually empowered to do something. But if we're going to do something, I would argue for a lower tax, because I think that's actually more interesting and more exciting.
Right, well, I'll take your point. That's expanded on a little bit. I mean, the comment's been made somewhere that, you know, our taxes here are actually relatively low by European standards, and we could quite safely increase it a bit. Is that your opinion?
Well, it depends what, it depends who you're looking at. And I can't remember, Reform Scotland did do the figures on what percentage tax takes across the board, and they have changed in the last 3 years, so I'm not totally up to date. But the UK was pretty much in the middle of European, how much tax you raise compared to how much tax as a percentage of GDP. So you can always look at the Scandinavian countries and say they have a much higher percentage, but that's been falling. And of course, if you look at the Scandinavian countries, you'd have to argue that a lot of more of their taxes is done at a much more local level than is done in the UK. So different societies, and this is a huge question, so if you want to be specific, you've now broadened it right out. Different societies have a very different attitude to how much tax they take, and you can make all sorts of arguments on that. I think what the Scandinavian model, which I think is the one that is significantly higher than the rest of Europe, would demonstrate is that people feel more comfortable about paying greater taxes if they feel there is greater community engagement and those taxes relate more directly to the local spending that they have. And I go back to all party statements that seems to be a trend that all parties actually believe in at the moment, because their statements are towards empowering more local government and communities.
No, that's fair. Ms. Blackburn, did you want to comment on that? But compared to other countries, how do you feel we are?
It's not my own expertise. I think you'll find other people.
Okay. Well, the last area I really wanted to get kind of question about, which was touched on by the convener, is can we get any kind of grasp on how elastic or how mobile all of this is? That, you know, by putting a penny I think we got the suggestion before that by putting a penny on or off the rate will not mean a lot of people move around. I mean, have you got any kind of feeling as to what level it would be that people would start moving? Or does anybody have this idea? Because we're going to have to make a judgment on this.
I mean, the mobility of populations and the sensitivity of individuals to economic signals is a thing that people do study. I don't know in the tax world what evidence would look like here, interestingly, because each society is slightly different. The issues that would allow or constrain mobility vary from country to country. You could look, and I can't give you the evidence, but if the committee was interested here, there would be people who would know, for example, the United States. It's very common in many federal countries for the devolution of income tax to operate at a sub-federal level. So there will be places in the world, but the geography will be different. Somewhere like Germany might have it, I don't know. So what I would say from student funding, which is a thing I know more about, is that actually mobility is massively complex, and the people who do study this, that if you look across the island of Ireland is quite a nice example because there's different funding regimes, it's cheaper to go south than north or whatever. What you find is that population mobility is driven by all kinds of things that are nothing to do with economic signalling, that it's very easy to pick out that one thing. And I'm quite sure Ben is right, there would be a point at which surely it must matter more substantially. But I think it's playing always against family ties, where you can get the job you want, where your kids are, where you want to live, quality of life, all sorts of things. So I'm sceptical, I have to say, that small tax increases, I think David Bell clearly has done more on this, but my feeling is the threshold for evidence that you're going to get a big mobility effect by relatively small changes in income tax, I find that hard to see from any evidence.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Thomson, do you want to comment on that one?
I think Lucy summed it up very well. I think that a very small increase, a 1% increase or decrease, is not going to influence people's actual change, but it will send out a message about the intentions of the direction of travel. And like all these things, you can't quite put your finger on it. It's a question of confidence. And you reach a tipping point where it suddenly does make a difference. Mm-hmm. And therefore, it's accumulation of a lot of things rather than any one particular thing.
But that confidence, as Ms. Blackburn said, will be quality of life,
sure,
family, as well as what the tax rate is. So there's a whole, even confidence is made up of a number of factors.
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Just for clarification, Ben, just before we go on, about what questions you were asked. I mean, the questions were asked were, what should the rate be for SRIT and why? If SRIT should be above 10%, how should the additional funding be allocated? And if SRIT should be below 10%, how should the reduction be funded from existing public expenditure? So you really had freedom to basically say, we weren't restricted to a zero-sum game there, as you seem to have been suggesting. Anyway, Jean, to be followed by Mark.
Thank you. A number of my points have been covered, and thank you for that. Interesting. I'd quite like to go back, Ben, to your argument about the image of Scotland, and that you used the phrase "open for business." All of that is, I mean, you know, I kind of take the other argument that actually a country that is, that for all the other reasons of welfare and public spending on public services makes it more attractive. Why do you see that as such a key to reducing income tax?
I think the reason for suggesting this is it sends an interesting message, and it's different. And I think the one that John asked, which is about change, it's important to have change. But I do think that when you mean open for business, I think business and the general population is fed up about how complicated tax is and the illogicality of a lot of taxes. And I do think that they want more engagement at a local level. So combining those things, I mean, if you wanted to be really radical, Jean, why not say, and I think Kezia may have actually mentioned this in a Guardian article last month, which is to say that the powers that come down to Scotland, let's see a lot of those powers be passed on to local government. And that's a sort of open for business, how you actually empower people right down to a community level. So perhaps being really radical, you should take all 10p and say, why don't we let local government have their own income tax rate, and rather than raising 20% through council tax of what they spend, actually being responsible for the majority of what they spend. I mean, that's what I mean by being open for business, that actually government starts thinking about you are a provider of public services, which obviously we all understand need to be funded, but let's do that in a way that actually is simpler and engages us more.
I agree with all of that about being creative about how we use tax. However, Scottish Government is going to be fairly limited in this. I mean, you mentioned tax on sugar and thinking differently about taxes earlier on in your opening remarks, but these powers are not with Scotland. Do you think that Scotland should have power over all its taxation?
Well, as you know, as I've said on many occasions, I was a huge advocate of Devo Plus, which says that each level of government should be broadly responsible for raising the money that they spend. And that is at local government level and at Holyrood level and at Westminster level, because that really makes politicians responsible and accountable if they have to do that. And if you look at, I think one mentioned the United States, if you look at the United States, the difference in state taxation in terms of how they go about raising their taxes and making sure that it's right for their local communities is huge. So some states have no income tax and raise it all through property taxes and sales taxes, and some have no sales taxes and raise it all through property and income tax. So they have a real different attitude, and actually that they embrace the difference. And so it would be slightly sad if all we did, if we got these powers for tax, is we would just mirror everything else that happens around the rest of the UK and kept all these tax rates the same and didn't use as an opportunity to make Scottish taxation system better. And I think the Cabinet are suggesting that quite a lot of taxes can be more flexible. So I'm not sure it would stop us having a sugar tax or radically revising council tax at the same time as balancing that with passing the Scottish rate of income tax down to these more localised taxes.
I think, do you agree that one of the issues just now is that people want to see, we use fairer, the word fairer a lot in terms of taxation in Scotland, and we'd like to close the gap to see people at the lower end being much better off and taxing people who are high earners a bit more. But it seems to me that to reduce income tax by 2% and perhaps using Lucy's table, but to increase council tax by 30% isn't achieving that. I mean, it's, as everybody says, taxation does give with one hand and takes away with another. But the impression I get is that a lot of people are thinking that we should pay more council tax because they feel that that's directly, rightly or wrongly, of course, related to diminishing public services. So that... Well, my question is that should the basis of any rethinking on taxation be about being fairer?
Well, fairness is a very difficult word and is used a lot at the moment, so what do you mean by fair? I would step back and say, as a very start, if Scotland wants to be seen as being progressive, let's have a more transparent, simpler taxation system. I think it was said that in the last 15 years, Tollies has not only doubled, but which is the tax guide, but has also seen its font shrink from 12 to 8 so that it could get it all in. It has become very complicated. 85% of taxes are raised through property, income, and sales taxes of one sort or another. Why don't we actually accept that and devise a much simpler taxation system that recognises that and shares that equally, rather than having this very complicated taxation system and welfare system that goes with it that actually... people struggle with. I mean, I have people saying, I had someone this morning who was struggling because they had to fill in their tax self-assessment form for the first time. It really is quite difficult for people to understand our tax taxation system. We've just been looking at Reform Scotland at a welfare programme. It is very difficult. Why not start by actually having a taxation system beyond fairness that is transparent, that people can really understand? Because fairness starts by people actually understanding what's going on and therefore being able to vote on it.
Okay. I guess just finally, I can see the newspaper headline of 2% reduction in income tax and 30% increase in council tax not being politically acceptable apart from anything else. I agree with you about the local tax, but given that these are under review at the moment as well as to how we fund local government, then the Scottish rate of income tax possibly is, in a wider view, is going to be something that's looked at on its own. And I think that since the referendum, people are much more inclined. We've talked a lot about Scandinavian countries and Scandinavian tax rates versus public services. Would you think, and perhaps Lucy would have an opinion about this too, do you think that the public mood at the moment is far more accepting of two things? One, that there definitely needs to be an increase in wages, and that's another question, but that together with an increase in income tax would actually suit the public mood?
The only evidence I've seen on that is some opinion polling, which, if you're arguing the case I'm arguing, is a little bit depressing. In that, on the whole, I think it's a hard sell to the public. And at one level, people will embrace and talk about higher public services, but it's a constant battle is to actually persuade people to do that. So I'm probably suggesting, and I say this with my former civil service hat on, that the political classes in Scotland do something rather brave, which is advice that, you know, whole... ministers don't generally welcome. I think it is a hard sell. I think it's important to differentiate between, if you like, some of the what one sees, whether social media or in the press and the arguments put, and actually people out there. And I think if tax was going up, then even by one or two pence, then it would need to be very. You came back to how do you sell it? How do you persuade people? I think you wouldn't have to. You mustn't underestimate that it would be a serious job, and there would be voices and there should be advocates out there on your side. There really ought to be. The people who are unhappy with public service cuts ought to be on the side of tax raisers. But even still, organisations, you see it in the STUC submission, find themselves split between their interests as service providers, their interests as representatives of workers. So I think the case is compelling if you're worried about public service cuts, but I don't think you should underestimate how difficult that job would be.
Penny for Scotland. Mark to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you very much, convener. I just wonder, in terms of the overall framework, and we've kind of strayed through the discussion into other areas of taxation, and some of which are not the responsibility of the Scottish Government and are not likely to become the responsibility of the Scottish Government anytime soon. So leaving the hypotheticals to one side for a moment, what is the... I suppose the vulnerability of SRIT to policy decisions that are made at Westminster. I'm thinking in particular in terms of issues around the personal allowance, because obviously decisions around the personal allowance would have a direct impact on the amount of money that could be raised as a consequence of changes to SRIT.
Do you want to go, Ben? Immensely important question, clearly, because you're in an interactive system and one bit a lever gets pulled here and it affects that. So a great deal hangs here on the extent to which there's open and proper discussion, what kind of mechanisms are happening behind the scenes, because obviously there's an underpinning, if you take 10p away, how the underpinning financial transfers behind all this. I saw there's a story just this week about gift aid and what might happen with gift aid and so on. So clearly it's a complex system, and you're absolutely right that other bits of it might get changed, and the answer is I don't know, but the question would be not precisely what would happen in those circumstances, but do we have the mechanisms that ensure a fair adjustment to any underlying financial transfers? And that, I think, would be the really key thing, and the committee no doubt will be exploring at some point what the underlying financial transfers are. But it's all doable, but a lot then hangs on the rationality of the liaison systems underneath.
Yeah.
I was going to say, as I've set out in this committee before, if you're wanting a proposal, I think that
again, matching fiscal powers with spending powers is important. And if you're going to give fiscal powers, you should actually give the full fiscal powers, which includes all the banding and the thing and the thresholds at the bottom, particularly as we also advocated when I was at Reform Scotland that welfare should be devolved to the area that the responsibility was for providing the welfare. And I think if you're going to try and create a holistic welfare system at a particular level for a particular part of government, you need to be able to match what happens with taxation in that area with what happens with welfare. So if you're looking at that bottom area around the lowest payers of tax, to be able to take welfare and match it with the personal allowance is an important tool to be able to implement policy decisions about the low paid.
Obviously, I mean, you've mentioned in terms of the mechanisms, the adjustment mechanisms that will exist, and obviously as part of the ongoing discussions around the Scotland Bill, there's discussion around developing the fiscal framework that will determine allocations and adjustments. That won't be in place at the point at which SRIT is going to be enacted. So those fiscal rules as such won't apply in this instance. At the same time, if we take the two possible scenarios that you've highlighted, in terms of Ben, your submission, you've spoken about reduction would increase spending, which would result in a boost in income through, for example, increase in VAT. Now, there are proposals on the table in the Scotland Bill for assignment of VAT, and there are discussions around how much of that should be assigned, but that won't happen at the point of transfer of this power. At the same time, also looking at Lucy's submission, one of the concerns that has been raised previously is if you have control of income tax on income but not tax on dividend, there is the potential at the higher end for some people to transfer income to dividend income, which would result in a boost to the Treasury rather than a boost to the Scottish Government. So I guess it's how do you envisage those risks being managed? Because obviously if we don't get the VAT income assigned at the point of SRIT, it's not the Scottish Government who gets the benefit of that increased spending in its initial when it initially happens. And then also around the possibility of transfer, should those at the higher end choose to do that in a way to avoid the tax increase that may come?
In my submission, Mark, I don't make any allowance for the fact that any impact and what it does will increase the economy, and therefore you're trying to get a benefit from the economy that will come through. Had I done that, I would agree with your argument that, you know, it doesn't really work if then you don't have some money back from the improvements in the economy. There you would, of course, through things like business rates and such like, because of the local level, you would get that. As you know, I'm not a particularly great fan of assigned taxes generally, as they only give you half the benefit. You can't actually use them as fiscal levers. All you can do is get the benefit or the disadvantage on what happens with the economy in the country. So I think that you do get, I haven't factored in into any other into my submission, which is you get the benefit of the economics of a rising Scotland if that happens. You do a bit through things like business rates anyway, but I would agree with you that when we come to the next step, these arguments will become quite prevalent when we look at the Calman proposals and how they get implemented in the Scotland Bill.
I think the question of behavioural effects, obviously it's an unknown, we haven't been here before, and you could catch an income to dividend switch at the top end, that's possible. I suppose my observation would be that as long as it's still in tax, that's still taxable income being taxed somewhere, and that spending coming out of the Treasury is what underpins still a great deal of the welfare system, a great deal of public spending in Scotland is still underpinned by Treasury. My worry would be more if there was an evident way in which it opened up a way of taking income right out of tax. In that case, it's a net loss to the public purse. I would tend to want to envisage this more in questions of the public purse. The money will be spent. But clearly, from the point of view of the Scottish Government, the big issue is how predictable, and that's a very fair point. If they put a penny on income tax, how predictable is that going to be? And so they would need to know from the point that they made that decision that there wasn't that, that what the tax threshold say was going to be, what the good and had the best possible predictions of what the take was going to be. And there's quite a lot of variation in what the predictions are on the take. I think that's maybe one of the most tough things in all of this.
So just one final question, and I suppose it's probably directly to yourself, Ben, is that you've spoken in your submission about looking at other ways of raising the money that would be lost to the Scottish Government through a reduction. It struck me from listening to it two things. Well, one, I'm intrigued by the sellability of a significant hike in the council tax, but leaving that to one side, the other thing you've mentioned is a tax on sugar products. I'm just wondering, one, how applicable that would be, given that, you know, I could buy a box of all brand cereal and the second highest ingredient in that is sugar. But it's not the first thing people would think of when they thought of a sugary product. And secondly, in terms of that, where you think the effect of such a tax would fall, because I suspect that you would find that it would be disproportionately towards those on lower incomes, because those tend to be the areas where we do have problems around uptake of high sugar products. So is it not essentially an indirect tax that is regressive?
I mean, the analysis that I've seen shows it's fairly widely now across society that we an average adult in Scotland eats between 60 grams and 80 grams of sugar a day, and that has got a lot of problems. Now, when you say it's buried in things like cereals, yes, but if you start putting the tax up, it'll encourage manufacturers to look at other ways of making their products without using so much sugar, because we are getting a huge amount of sugar. Taxes can be used for two things. One is to raise money, but they can also be used to change behavior, which is what we've seen in taxation on smoking, which is, I think, you know, cigarette tax is about 77% of the face cost of a packet of cigarettes, same with alcohol. And we have to face up to the fact that Scotland does have a significant health issue. Diabetes is illnesses related to obesity are causing the NHS real problems. And, you know, if we want, I think it's been said by a number of the parties that we want a healthier society to live in, then we can use some of these taxes to actually change people's behavior. And it would seem an obvious one that sugar tax would be one of those. That sends an interesting message out, and it also then helps to raise some revenues.
Okay, Gavin, before by Jackie.
Thank you. Like the convener, I too like the fact that both of you effectively stuck your necks out and came down with concrete proposals from differing sides. Ben, if I ask you first, and you've been very specific, it's a 2 pence tax cut, which I personally quite like. But I mean, can I ask for the specifics of what was behind the 2 pence? Why was it not 1 pence or 3 pence, for example? Was there anything specific about 2 pence that drew you to it?
Not really, to be honest with you. I mean, it's more psychological than anything else. 1p looks a bit, if you're going to do something, 1p looks a bit pathetic, really. And if you did 100%, people would say, well, you're not being really credible. So it's somewhere between 1p and 10. I mean, you know, there's an argument to say, look, just give all of the Scottish rate of income tax down to local government and allow local government to fund itself through the income tax. So, you know, I thought that this was a sort of somewhere that the public would probably feel it's a significant, sure, but it's not outrageous.
Okay, no, thank you. And I guess a similar question to you, Lucy. You've said 1.5 pence tax increase. Why not 1 pence or 2 pence? What was this? Was it purely to fund the council tax issue? Was there something more behind the 1.5 pence?
I was entirely looking at what I thought the revenue base loss was since 2008, that sort of 560, and 1.5p seemed to be, across a range of predictions, roughly the amount you needed to fill that gap. So I was absolutely looking at restoring the lost tax income to the Scottish Government since 2008.
Okay, thank you. And Lucy, to you again, I mean, I'm just keen to see your position on the council tax freeze. So you feel that to reverse it in its entirety in one go would be unsustainable, and so you're not suggesting that.
And you're using the extra money collected from income tax, I guess, to offset it. What is your sort of view, though, on the council tax freeze as it stands? Should the freeze continue in its current form for now, or are you saying it should now increase by inflation, assuming there is any inflation, but it should increase on an annual basis from now on, but you mainstream that 560 and offset it? Are you saying the freeze should remain in its entirety?
Personally, I'm with Ben that the gearing that becomes more and more acute the longer you freeze the council tax is a bad thing in terms of that relationship between spending and local choice. So I would be in favour of unfreezing the council tax. I also think the longer you freeze it, the bigger the task you've got ahead of you in getting local taxation back on some kind of sustainable footing. And we have we're kind of educating a population in not paying tax for local services in a visible way, and that worries me. So I would be inclined to let it go up in the coming year as part of the process of transition. But I would agree. I mean, it's unfortunate that we can't do that in a context where we've, say, elongated the bands at the top, but it's not practical to do that.
If you look at property taxes, there are two, basically. There's business rates and there's council tax that are based on property. I think, if I remember the numbers, council tax was 1.9 billion in Scotland and business rates was 2 billion, something like that, which comes to roughly 4 billion out of the 56 billion that is raised in taxation in Scotland. That is a very low percentage. We do very low percentage tax on property. And actually, if you think of a modern society going forward, a society that is much more global and that can move around, actually linking taxes to where you have a guardianship of a property or land in Scotland or anywhere in the world makes a lot of sense. So actually, I think we've got our taxation mix wrong, because as we increasingly go global and people can increasingly do things and run their businesses in a global way, actually the things that remain very localized are where people live, where people have properties, and therefore actually 8% or whatever it is raised through property tax is low, and we should start actually really reassessing property tax in the overall mix of taxes.
Okay. I would agree with that.
Okay, and just the other final question, because again, many of mine have been covered. This is one for you, Ben. I mean, while I am personally attracted to the 2 pence tax cut, obviously you're offsetting that with an increase to the council tax, and so it does become revenue neutral. In terms of your open for business argument, do you not have some concern that the council tax changes or the council tax offsetting that you're proposing might counteract the open for business argument on income tax? Because, you know, again, you can see the headlines. People read about a 2% tax cut and then they read about a 30% tax increase. And while the overall money is the same, people will see 2 versus 30 and potentially, anyway, draw a negative conclusion, particularly given that one is taxed at source, and so people sometimes don't notice it as much, whereas the council tax is something you physically, well, I know it's done by direct debit and so on now, but people, it physically comes out of your bank account. I just wonder, have you given much thought to that?
Now talking about spin, which is probably more your areas than my own, but I mean, it would seem to me that another headline could be, isn't it great that Holyrood, instead of being centralist, is actually doing something about really passing powers from Holyrood on down to local government? And these new powers that are coming in, we're actually passing down to local government. And actually, if it was up to me, I would say, if local government decide not to do it through council tax, but want to have their own different, you know, whatever it is, bedroom taxes or income taxes or whatever it is, let them start to actually take some responsibility for fiscal management, rather than, you know, taking away the business rate from them, capping their council tax. All of those messages are messages that we don't trust you to run your own fiscal affairs. If you really want a message of we're empowering local government, then give local government proper fiscal responsibility. And I think both Lucy and I are saying use this opportunity to empower local government. And I've got you know, statements from you, all of your parties, about how you want to empower local government. This is an opportunity to do it.
Okay, grateful. Thank you.
Brief supplementary from Jean.
If that message is the one that's sold with a 30% increase in council tax, and given that you've acknowledge that that actually just balances the budget, then the argument it falls, doesn't it? Because nobody's going to see any more money spent on public services without increasing it even more.
What the argument I'm making is you are, irrespective of, you know, and rather than changing the size of the cake in any shape or form, you're actually empowering local government. So by actually giving back proper powers to local government. So that's the message that I would take from this, is that you're using these tax powers that are coming down not to form a mini Westminster in Holyrood, but actually to empower communities and local government to do more. And that, I think, is a very strong message that people identify with. And if, I don't know, you're independent, Jean, so I mean, I don't know if, you know, I haven't seen your own statements on localism, but I would hope that you also are a supporter of, you know, empowering local communities and local government.
Government and local communities, if poorer local authorities have a lot less money, and what would happen is that places like Edinburgh would have a much stronger tax base without equalisation than the local authorities round about. I mean, North Lanarkshire compared to Glasgow, huge amounts of money are spent in Glasgow from people in North Lanarkshire, my own area, North Ayrshire. What would happen is that the more prosperous areas would become more prosperous, and the poorer areas would simply become poorer because the tax base is clearly weaker.
I disagree with that, Kenneth. I think the real responsibility of central government, or one of the real responsibilities of central government, is to manage that level of wealth redistribution, so that you know, if you look at us within Europe, people actually accept that the net is 6 billion is going to help poorer countries in Europe. In the same way, at a Westminster level, you know, money is being redistributed. So the job of one of the jobs of Holyrood is actually the money that's raised at Holyrood actually helps to those areas that need economic regeneration or that have suffered a particular...
You've just been arguing against that, have you not, all morning?
No, I haven't been arguing against that. What I'm saying is one of the responsibilities of central government is an element of wealth redistribution, but it's not to raise all the tax and then pass taxations down. So let me give you an example of why this is a problem. If you took the Barnett formula and you said, okay, each level of government, Scotland would raise its own money, and Wales would raise its own money, and Ireland would raise its own money, and England would raise its own money, you would need approximately 10 billion to rebalance all the books so they're exactly the same as they were before, raised centrally. So rather than have all the money going into Westminster and then redistributed by the budget formula, you actually have all the individual areas, by and large, raising their money, but having... if they need, and I think if you look at the Welsh proposals, they're actually quite good on this, is the extra element of redistribution then helps those areas in need of economic redistribution or have deprivation.
Okay, Lucy's desperate to comment then, Jackie.
It's actually to build on Ben's comment. For my sins, the first job I was given in the Scottish Government in 1995 was working out how to break up the budgets or the government funding that underlay the budgets of the regional councils. So I spent a lot of time taking apart the Strathclyde money. And what becomes very apparent is what the process Ben is describing. It's that there is never going to be an equity of tax base. And you look at the tax base of Inverclyde or West Dunbartonshire, it is radically different to that of Edinburgh or East Renfrewshire, for example. So I couldn't subscribe to a view that was sort of radical, everyone raises their own money, because you'd end up with fantastic amounts of inequity. So what I think where Ben and I sort of converge is that there is a better balance than we could currently achieve, where you would still need a system of quite substantial financial transfer happening. Central government retains that role, because without that, some communities would just suffer quite disproportionately. But we could achieve that without having such a high degree of government funding. We could give more freedom to local communities to raise money. And I guess it's that balance is where we would agree the balance isn't being struck in the right place at the moment. Just on property taxation, I think it's massively important we look more at that. And if you look at, say, the work of Thomas Piketty or whatever, he brings out that kind of property wealth is where global wealth inequity is increasingly concentrating around property, and we need to think about that as using local taxation powers is one of our strongest levers to do that here.
Okay, thank you very much, Jackie. To be followed by Richard.
Thank you. I'll resist the temptation to go off into property tax. I have to say, I think, Ben, you used the word exciting and taxes in the same sentence at least three times, so I'm going to have to check the definition in my dictionary. But let me put something to you. If you hadn't been, as you clearly felt constrained by the committee's questioning, if you hadn't felt that constraint, would the proposal on the table be just to reduce taxes by 2 pence?
No.
Okay, so you would have made this self-same proposal of increasing council tax.
I think we, and I've said this again to this committee 3 years ago, is we delude ourselves if we don't think we're in a very difficult position in public finances. We, in the UK, we have had a deficit of over 100 billion for 6 or 7 years now, since 2007, and you know, we only raise just under 600 billion of taxes in the UK. It is a substantial deficit that we still haven't got to grips with. And in order to tackle that, really tackle that, that is going to be, one can't just sort of tinker with it. One actually has to do a mixture of raising more taxes. We're going to have to do a mixture of looking at how we can be more efficient in the public sector. So there's got to be a balance. And while we're in these difficult times, I don't actually believe that we should be reducing the overall amount of revenue. In fact, we might have to increase it. But so I think that's important. We also need to make public sector more efficient. I think the public still doesn't quite appreciate that we are still in a very high level of deficit that we're running, and therefore we have to use lots of levers to get us back on track.
So you wouldn't advocate a tax cut in and of itself. You would recognise that we need at the least a cost-neutral budget, because anything else would you know, contribute to that deficit position.
Yes.
Fine. So what you're suggesting, forgive me, you said we were responsible for spin, but what you're suggesting looks to me like a bit of smoke and mirrors. Would that be fair?
No, because I think it's using it for two things. One is, I really do believe in this localism agenda. So, and you know, I can't stress enough, and I think on this issue, Lucy is the same, is this is a huge opportunity to empower local government, which has been denuded of fiscal powers to by and large over the last, more and more, particularly with the cap on council tax and the removal of the business rate from local government. The second thing is the taxation system in this country is both hideously complicated and not fit for purpose in the way that we're getting a more, I hate this word, but I'm going to say it, a more glocal world, which is to say that people want to see more local responsibility, but at the same time, our business interests and our personal interests and how we operate is done at a much more global level. And the complicated tax system that we have at the moment isn't going to suit the system of how society is going to work in the future. This is an opportunity to start looking at imaginative ideas. And the whole point about having powers at local levels is that we can explore different ways of doing things. Some will be mistakes, but some will actually be some good things. Other people will then pick up on that and start to have a proper debate.
I mean, I agree with Jean's point that I'm not sure local government would regard it as empowering to have to start off by making up a gap in revenues, but I absolutely agree with the principal point of, you know, pushing more locally. Can I ask you, therefore, to explain a bit more about your council tax proposal? You know, is it a 33% rise across all the bands? Are you aiming at the higher bands? If you are, that's those over £220,000. I can feel Gavin shivering beside me already. How many are actually in those bands, and what proportion would they pay?
Yeah, actually, I do think it's unfair at the moment that, and I say this totally against myself, I would end up paying more tax under my proposals. But I think property tax needs to be simplified and made fairer, in that the band that was set, the H band in 1991, doesn't take account of people who sit on really huge properties that actually should be affording possibly even not paying any income tax at all, who pay very low rates of council tax. And I think that's fundamentally unfair. And we should have a property tax that actually is fair across many more bands, or even, if you take away bands, is actually, now that you have much better valuation systems, as we start to progress towards a fixed percentage of property value.
Let me push you further on this, because you haven't answered the question whether it's 33% across the board, whether you would actually move some bands completely out of paying anything and load it onto those above 220,000.
Much rather see, because I would much rather see a, and if you want to push me to be radical, a flat percentage of property value right the way across. Now, at the moment, if you're in band A, you're paying over 1% of your property value. If you're in a £100,000 flat in Edinburgh, you're paying over 1% of the property value per year in council tax. If you look at it at a person who's got £1 million property plus, that's lower than 0.3%. So you would, you know, if I'm extending this, you would pay, relatively speaking, three times more at the top end than the bottom end. Now that is adjusting because you don't, you wouldn't be paying three times more absolute because of the way the numbers work. But you would see a much more spread that would shift to people on wealthier homes. Now, the next question will be, there are some people who have very little income who sit on very wealthy homes. So you're going to have a, something of a process of transferring to that, because particularly the elderly might be low income, high property value. But we've got the kilter and the balance wrong. So we've got to find a way of moving from the current system, which I do think is unfair at the moment, to a system that more reflects the underlying property wealth that people have.
Is currently being grappled with by the Commission. But there you go.
I may have to give evidence there, but I wait to see the Commission's evidence when it comes out.
Indeed. Lucy, I wonder whether I might ask you just a general question, because you acknowledge some sympathy with the Scottish Government's emerging position, which is, you know, more nuanced powers come in the next tranche of the Smith Commission powers, but you felt austerity was such a pressing issue. And it was so in terms of political rhetoric as well. Would you regard it as a completely wasted opportunity if the Scottish Government didn't use their powers now?
Yes, I would. I would. I think once you start looking at the real reality of what's being removed out of the public sector and who's affected, I would. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener.
Richard? A brief, Convener. Now we've covered a lot of ground already, but my first question's for Ben Thomson, because Ben, what you propose is a very neat and in many ways attractive package in terms of cutting income tax, but then giving far more powers to local authorities and raising their own revenues. And that's obviously something we do all support. But is there not, clearly, I presume that would be a one-off relationship between SRIT and local government taxation. And is there not a danger? I mean, you've talked about sending out a signal for Scotland by these tax measures. Like, if your first act as Scottish Government is to cut your rate of income tax by 2%, there is a danger of creating long-term problems in terms of Scottish Government revenues and therefore further pressures down the line in terms of government spending. I mean, how would you foresee that working out in terms of the longer-term direction of travel in terms of taxation?
I don't quite understand the question. I think it sends out. I understand the bit about it sends out a direction of travel. I don't see why it affects the long term, because you balance the
If your first act's to cut tax by 2%,
yeah,
that's kind of embedded from the beginning. So mm-hmm. Everything you raise after that is from a lower base. But indeed, the political pressure may well be that we should remain either in a situation of cutting taxes or maintaining a lower tax base. And in the meantime, what's happening in terms of the council level is out with the control of the Scottish Government as well. So, I mean, the pressure there seems to me quite clearly about reducing the income for government as a whole across Scotland rather than increasing it or even maintaining it.
Now, I see where you're coming from now. No, I would see the messages that you put out now as being important, that you're actually addressing localism, you're actually using taxes to do something different to create simplicity. Now, there are a very limited range of taxes that you've got, a pretty blunt tool. When we get greater taxes that are coming in, and we touched on this, I mean, Mark touched on the more taxes that are coming in, I would hope that the more, and I've always argued this, that having a whole toolbox of taxes then enables you really to do some interesting things about how we address both taxation and welfare and create something that's that's fit for purpose. So when all these bans start coming in, I would fully expect that actually one starts looking at, you know, how the bans work, the size of the bans, where the bans start, to actually suit Scotland and to try things out. So actually doing something now, and I think this is a point that Lucy's making, actually sets out that, yes, when you get these powers, let's start talking about actually doing things with them that make a difference. And that's the direction of travel, that you're actually going to do something that works and fits for Scotland and test things out, so that when you get much more powers, you'll be able to do that as well. So for me, the fact that we've reduced it by 2p doesn't mean that forevermore you're locked into a 2p reduction. It sets out much more a direction of travel, which is when we get these new powers, we can do things with powers that actually make Scotland a really interesting place, because we're doing it differently and we're doing it with a thought in mind to achieve things, whether that's to try and address problems with sugar or trying to correct things with local councils or empowering local councils or a whole range of other things that we can use going forward. So that's the message, I think, of the direction of travel, that you're actually using the powers rather than you change it by 2p or 1.5p and that sets it forevermore as the income tax rate going forward in future.
Fair point. So you see a situation where they're using the powers for specific actions, but the overall tax takes would be pretty similar in terms of, do you see taxation in Scotland for the individual, you know, being higher than the rest of the UK in the longer term, or is it going to be pretty similar? It's just you're doing it in different ways. I mean, that's what I'm trying to sort of capture here.
This comes back to sort of Jackie's question in a way, is, look, we've got to manage Scotland, or you've got to manage Scotland, but we as a population have got to try and do things in Scotland as we do in UK, as we do in Europe, mm-hmm. that is going to create a vibrant economy and actually in the end produces a public sector that is financing itself without a deficit. You cannot run a sizable deficit of the size that we've got. So we've got to address this problem. And that means creating a mix of all sorts of different things. But unless you can actually be open and start exploring about how we address this, we're never going to get anywhere. And we need a real change of culture to address the problems that we're in at the moment. And for me, that real change of culture is getting people to actually do things at a local level to address this, to actually get people engaged at a local level. And if anything, in the last year, the level of political activism, I believe, is because people are actually feeling engaged at a local level. Let's draw on that to help us solve this problem by giving them more empowerment at a local level.
Thank you very much. My final question, Convener, is for Lucy Hunter-Blackburn. And it was one of the issues the committee has been very interested in for a long time is the idea of preventative spend. And it struck me that what you were saying about the current situation we have in terms of local government funding is almost the opposite of that. Because I think you said that with some of the recommendations that Edinburgh City Council's had to make, those are on the edge of being the most vulnerable or losing out on services. So in terms of making the arguments about why you'd want to increase taxation to invest in those services, presumably at this moment in time we're storing up some long-term problems and actually will create some severe pressures on the public purse rather than make government more efficient.
I think at that point I'd point to the much greater expertise here that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation have in the report they did in June 2013, and that's the point they made, that as budgets tighten and you keep pulling services back and back to the people deemed most vulnerable, education welfare officers in Edinburgh, we've cut the number in Edinburgh so that the threshold for intervention is no, it was 85%, it's had to fall. I don't know, but the equalities report I read didn't say what it was going to fall to. Fewer people will be helped. We will catch children who are beginning to fall out of the system less quickly. And that sort of model, that pattern will be replicated across. So absolutely, I think there is an argument around prevention, about intervention.
I mean, coming back to Ben's important point on localism, I mean, do you think there's a situation at the moment where, you know, some difficult decisions are having to be made at a local level with little flexibility mm-hmm. because some of those decisions perhaps aren't being made at a central government level? Is that perhaps too political a point?
No, I think it's enough. I mean, I've worked around local government funding a long time, and you become, if you work on local government funding for a while, you become a little bit hardened to some of the tales of woe mm-hmm. that councils do. I'm not completely Pollyanna about everything that comes through the press at budget setting time, and yet it is really striking. if you're sort of looking through, as I was in preparation for today, kind of comments. So West Dunbartonshire, this has been the most difficult budget process in the council's history, said the council leader. Highland is a very huge concern in Highland about 21 million cuts. And you go through and say, this is a very high degree of noise in the system about difficulty. Glasgow was making comments about one of the toughest decisions. So Edinburgh, we've got very tough. And it becomes the language of local government spending. And in some ways, it should be tough. I'm not against putting councils under pressure. Everybody has their own pet hate bit of council spending that they think should be cut. You know, we all do it. But there's a point at which you have to kind of watch for that prejudice making you deaf to real messages of strain in the system. And I think that's where I feel, if I look at the numbers and the messages, and more importantly, at the actual hard budget choices of a place like Edinburgh, that's where I begin to see there's something going on that requires, it is an urgent issue requiring some sort of action. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Richard. Now, that's concluded questions from the committee. I just wonder if there's any final brief points you might want to make of anything that's not been touched upon.
I'd only say that, I mean, if one looks south of the border, councils have already had to really address a lot of issues that, to some extent, councils up here have yet to face in terms of the amount of cuts that have happened. And I think that we do need to get a change of culture in getting people engaged, because these are problems that we all need to get involved with and share. And therefore, you know, to be able to actually start the empowerment of local government by making them more fiscally responsible, this is a real opportunity to do that, and we need to do it, as I think Lucy was saying, urgently now. So giving the direction of travel that we really are getting into a local agenda of passing powers down, I think this is a huge opportunity. I'd love to see you as politicians challenging the decisions that are going to happen over what the rate is, to try and be brave. Go on, be brave, and that's what we want from you.
So says a man who isn't coming up for election next year. Lucy?
I'm also asking you to be brave, because I'm also not coming up for election in a different way. I want to emphasise that Ben and I differ on a lot. We clearly share a very similar view on the importance of using the powers you've got, both symbolically and practically, and the localism agenda. And so I'm very keen, like Ben, to encourage you to look at the Scottish rate of income tax alongside council tax as a whole thing. But the point I really wanted to finish on was actually about who's round the table and whose voices you're going to hear in this debate, because you've heard me today talking about tax increases. If you're going to do something as difficult as recommend a tax increase, I looked at the range of people who'd replied to your inquiry, and of course you're in the hands of who replies. You get a lot of tax advisers, you get the voices of the wealthy in a debate about tax. They tend to pop up more, and they're more numerous, and they're more present, and they pay people a lot of money. I did this in my spare time on my sofa. I'm an amateur here, I really am. I have a bit of past professional history, but I'm not a tax expert. And neither am I an expert in public services and spending anymore. But there are people whose voices I really hope you would recognise. You haven't got round your table, you haven't got on your list, you haven't got the Poverty Alliance, you haven't got COSLA, I was surprised to see, you haven't got CAB, you haven't got Joseph Rowntree Foundation. There are plenty of people out there who I think I don't know why they're not at this table now.
Well, first of all, we have to have submissions that are worth actually interrogating people.
No,
and folk haven't got anything to say, there's not much point in us actually asking them. I mean, all these organisations that have been contacted as a matter of course,
completely.
Frankly, and we are having a number of panels on this particular issue, so we have to interrogate what we have in front of us. I take on board what your point is, but what you might want to ask some of these organisations why they haven't made submissions. No. I mean, we could perhaps have asked them instead of yourself, but we wouldn't have got such an interesting discussion.
I think my point, Convener, absolutely, you can only deal with what you've got. I suppose I'm just asking you to notice the absence of those voices in your list. I think the committee works with what you get completely, so I'm incredibly grateful. I'm very grateful to have had the chance to come today. But I want just to flag up, there are all kinds of voices who aren't there in your submissions, and just please notice that they're not.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. I would say that, just as a matter of interest, I actually met Mr. Jonathan Letocq, the Premier Minister of Guernsey, last night, a micro state of 63,000. He was telling me that they have no debt, ILO unemployment of 1.2%, flat rate tax of 20%, no VAT. So we have a wee bit of progress to actually go. Well, I'm hoping that you can actually fund that for me. No by-elections coming up, sadly, but just shows you. Okay, well, thank you very much for your time this morning. I really appreciate that. We'll have a recess until 11:10. Okay, folks, starting about 15 seconds, we're all here. Okay, we'll now continue to take evidence on the Scottish rate of income tax from our second panel of witnesses. I'd therefore like to welcome to the meeting Hazel Gough of the Chartered Institute of Taxation, Charlotte Barbour of ICAS, and Gwyneth Scholefield of PricewaterhouseCoopers. Members have received copies of all relevant submissions, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. And as you probably know, some of you have been here before, I will start off with the questions, and then we will go on to take questions from colleagues. Now, you may have seen some of the last session, which lasted a good 90 minutes. We'd have a kind of a bit of to and fro over tax rates, but I noticed that basically you've more or less taken the fifth on in terms of what level of Scottish rate of income tax should be set. You know, yes, indeed. Indeed, I was beginning to wonder about that. ICAS have said, and I quote, as a matter of policy, ICAS does not comment on the quantum of tax that may be raised by governments. The Chartered Institute of Taxation have said, we don't generally comment on the setting of rate of taxes. So we'll start with PricewaterhouseCoopers, because although PricewaterhouseCoopers have actually said, you know, that along the same lines, we don't really set, we don't really want to comment on the taxation. You kind of do a wee bit, actually, to be honest, because what you've said there is the existence of the rate-varying power rather than its use has prompted changes, but administering a rate that is different to the rate prevailing in the rest of the UK will add complexity and administrative costs, therefore clearly indicating that in actual fact... Gwyneth, you do actually support the status quo in terms of taxation. That seems to be the kind of message that's coming through here. And you've also said that decisions on setting the SRIT should not, in our view, ignore the potentially fiscally induced behavioural responses that Scottish, indeed, our UK taxpayers may have following a change in SRIT. So are, indeed, as PricewaterhouseCoopers basically saying that don't change it.
Is that basically, you know, it is a complex area. Awareness across the population is relatively low. We engage with a number of employers from a range of industry sectors, and the awareness is very low. It is a complex area. Administration and what is required is still not abundantly clear. Guidance has still not been finalised as to, if you like, those cases on the borderline. For those individuals who are perhaps more mobile, they are able to move if the rate fluctuates, and that actually drives investment and the economy in Scotland to a certain extent, and therefore we're saying be mindful of what you do. I guess the changes post-Smith are coming down relatively quickly, and perhaps to embed what is a Scottish taxpayer into the minds of Scottish taxpayers before you change.
Sorry to interrupt you. I'm going to go into those things, but I'm more interested in, at this point in time, in the issues of, you know, trying to tease out of you, so to speak. And you can hint, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, but you don't really want to see a change in the 10p tax rate. Would I be more or less right in saying that?
I think that, you know, just keep the status quo would probably be better, while, you know, you're trying to embed a new tax regime into the Scottish.
So you're not ruling it out, of course, but what you're saying is, look, given the first year here, maybe we should, you know, let's see how things go, and then we should be looking to be perhaps a bit more radical one way or the other, whether it's raising or lowering taxes in the years ahead. Would I be more or less right in saying that?
I'd say, yeah. I'd say, you know, see how you go in the first year, let the thing embed, and what you do with future powers post-Smith will obviously need careful modelling, but yeah, perhaps do something differently then.
Okay, in terms of behavioural responses, you've said in terms of your impact on tax revenue section that there may be no significant increase in revenues associated with higher tax due to the ability of income returners to relocate within the UK. And this follows on from the bit I've already mentioned about behavioural responses. Now, we took evidence from Professor Bell some months ago, who said that, you know, if there's a 2 or 3% difference, there's no evidence that there's going to be any behavioural change. You're not going to sell your house in Edinburgh and move somewhere south of the border, whatever it is, on a 2 or 3% change. Have you got any indication of what kind of change of taxation, whether it's lowering tax to
for people to come here, who may be high earners, or raising tax that would impact adversely on that? Is the PricewaterhouseCoopers have any kind of idea of where that kind of margin might be?
We haven't done any specific modelling around that. I suspect that you, as the Scottish Government, will probably be doing some modelling around that for yourselves. So no, we don't have any evidence around that. What I would say is, from the clients we engage with, uh-huh. and for the most higher rate additional taxpayers, history tells us that there is a mobility in that section of the taxpaying population, and therefore it is likely that some of them will move depending on what you do with the rate.
Okay. First of all, I point out we're not the Scottish Government.
Sorry.
clearly. Charlotte, in terms of behavioural responses, I know you've decided that you don't want to comment on the rate, but in terms of behavioural responses, what are ICAS's view on behavioural responses? Have you any anecdotal evidence even in terms of what kind of threshold would have an impact?
Start by saying we've no statistical evidence. We do get anecdotal evidence, probably just the same way as Gwyneth does, that some of the more mobile top end and modelling, anecdotal evidence seems to lend itself to the rate going up. And if that were the case, you do hear stories about houses in Berwick, Northumberland, what have you. I have no idea how much strength there is in that or not. What I would say perhaps about behavioural responses is that I think over all my years as a tax practitioner, sometimes they're more quirky than you would automatically expect. And that can be in either direction.
Okay, that's fine. Hazel? CIOT, what's your view on the behavioural responses to increases?
I think the committee should be mindful of the fact that if the status quo is not maintained, then taxpayer behaviour does need to be considered. They may accelerate or defer income if they are in a position to do that. They may also base themselves either south or north of the border, whichever suits, in terms of determining whether or not they are a Scottish taxpayer in the first instance. The people who have the more complex cases where it's not particularly straightforward as to whether or not they are a Scottish taxpayer are likely to be the most mobile within our employment sector.
No idea what kind of level of threshold it might be, a 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%.
Okay. No
that's fine. Let's go on to your own submission. In terms of advisors and agents, section 5.7, you say, in terms of talking about HMRC, you talk about a series of campaigns being required, and you say that we think HMRC have adopted a sensible approach in terms of the order of campaigns, firstly advisors and agents, followed by employers and pension providers, and finally taxpayers, the general public. But in the following paragraph, you go on to say, we're concerned, however, that not enough has been done to publicise the SRIT among advisors and agents or to provide them with sufficient information at an early enough stage. Well, professional bodies like the CIOT can reach their members. This is only a proportion of advisors and agents. So can you tell us a bit more about your concerns on this? And then I'll obviously ask the other panellists to come in.
In terms of publicity, we are starting from a very low base. We have not undertaken any surveys, but based on comments we have received from the members, awareness is very low in terms of the introduction of the Scottish rate of income tax from next April.
Okay, I mean, Charlotte, you've said that there is as yet very little detailed information for taxpayers about the SRIT. Is that a concern that you have?
Again, we're all on anecdotal evidence at the moment, and I think it's quite difficult for HMRC to get the timing right, as I said in the submission, too soon. It's no use, too late, and it's no use. It's quite a difficult one to time. But lots of our members seem to be getting a bit twitchy that they ought to know about the Scottish rate of income tax. Mm-hmm. And in actual fact, I think once they do know about it, there's not so much that needs to be known. But the worry is we haven't quite crossed that boundary just yet, that mm-hmm. it's going to follow PYE procedures in the main, or, you know, for agents, it's relatively straightforward through the self-assessment, in broad terms. And once they know that, then I think folk might relax slightly more. But SRIT seems to have got completely lost in all the Smith noise.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Gwyneth?
I'd agree with Charlotte and Hazel. I think HMRC have taken a very pragmatic approach to agents and advisors engaging in Scotland as well as in the rest of the UK. I think the awareness is relatively low. It's a low base in Scotland, and I would say it's an even lower base outside of Scotland, and there are people who are affected in that area. So I think there is probably something that needs to be done. But as Charlotte quite rightly points out, it's a timing thing. I think coming back to one of the points that Hazel made around the deferment of income and mobility, I think there's still some nuances in the guidance that are still being finalised from HMRC, although we understand that that's going to be be published towards the end of this month. And I think that will actually, the way that that is released, will actually help, if you like, calm people and get them to see that, you know, probably there isn't a lot for the individuals to do, that the majority of people will either be in or out, if you like, is the way I describe it. So I think, yeah, it is a timing thing.
Okay, thank you. Now Charlotte, in your submission, paragraph 18, you add to effectively what Gwyneth is saying by saying that there also appears to be a lack of awareness among employers out with Scotland, which has obviously just been said. But in the previous paragraph, you also say that a number of our members in their capacities as agents and as employers have expressed concern about their role in the collection of SRIT and the lack of operational information about SRIT collection. So I'm just wondering if you can...
I think lots of employers and agents to a certain extent too, I think there's lots of concerns that generally it tends to be employers that operate PYE, and therefore what's their role going to be? Are they going to have to identify Scottish taxpayers? Are they going to have to explain what it means? Are they going to have to do something completely different to PYE? And in actual fact, when you get there, no, they're not, because HMRC are going to be issuing the S codes, and although employers might be encouraged to assist in the process, the employer role is actually very informal. It's just a kind of stopgap to help out, because you tend to go to HR before you phone HMRC. So actually employers don't have to do a lot, but if they don't know that, they're all slightly kind of twitchy, for want of a better way to put it. And I'd say in the past few weeks even, maybe the holidays have finished and everybody's got what's ahead of us, there's been a massive increase in interest in Scottish rate of income tax. There's been quite a few courses run amongst the profession on that recently. Maybe it's beginning to pick up.
Okay. Well, I mean, Hazel, you know, you said in 5.16 of your submission, you said, we are disappointed that HMRC and the Scottish Government have jointly agreed it is not necessary to show the SRIT separately on Form P60. The CIOT had called for details about the SRIT to be shown on the Form P60 as a minimum, and also raised the issue of it being on pay slips too. So I wonder if you can expand a wee bit on your views on why you feel that way, and obviously I'll let others in to comment, and then I'll open out the session to colleagues around the table.
We feel that it's important that taxpayers know how much they are paying in terms of tax and to whom they are paying that tax. And many taxpayers, the only information that they have will be in the form of their Form P60. So if it is not detailed on that form, then they will not know how much they are paying under the Scottish rate of income tax.
Okay, Gwyneth?
I can see Hazel's point of view that it's clear that, you know, individuals like to know where their tax is going, but I also understand, because of the, if you like, the limited time before the introduction of the Scottish rate of income tax, perhaps the complexity of breaking it out at this stage, given the information that people have, was almost a little bit of a complexity too far. So I think, you know, I can understand why we are where we are.
So what you say is, I mean, if there's not going to be any change, it's not necessary really for this year anyway, but perhaps in future years that's something you would like to see?
I would say, yeah, probably that would make sense, providing that the guidance is there as to how it is.
If you think about it, once we get the Smith taxes, the whole lot will be Scottish, so it's academic once you're on to Smith. And at the moment, it would have been a nice to have, but how many people look at their pay slips and their P60s realistically? And we've certainly attended a number of workshops where just the process mechanics of it, I can completely understand how the decision's been reached. The other thing that one has to remember is that PAYE was never designed to highlight how much tax you're paying.
Yeah, so you think it might be a bit of a sledgehammer to crack, or not really?
Well, I just think it's quite difficult to put out some really strong tax messages using PAYE, because they don't go together.
Okay, that's interesting. Okay, I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table, and the first will be Deputy Convener John, followed by Jackie.
Okay, I think fairly briefly, but we had a discussion at the previous, I'm not asking you an opinion on rates going up or down, but it's more the kind of technical side of things, as to whether it is progressive or regressive to add a penny or take a penny off the 20p, because there was the argument was basically that on the one hand, somebody who's earning more would pay proportionately more, but if you add a penny on to both 20p and 40p and 45p, then as a proportion for the bottom, that's 1p on 20 is 5%, 1p on 45 is less than that. I mean, I don't know if you use terms progressive and regressive, but can you comment on that argument as to, you know, who gets hit most or who gets hit less if we added a p on to a penny on?
Who's this to, John? Anybody specific?
I'm happy. I should have declared, by the way, I'm a member of ICAS, but yes, let's go for Charlotte.
Well, as a fellow member of ICAS, here we go. I think that's an interesting discussion. There's different ways of cutting that one, isn't there? And I think some of David Bell's work's really interesting because although, you know, it would depend on whether you're looking at the individual or whether you're looking at everybody, wouldn't it? Because there's David Bell's work suggests that there's down the bottom end of the income distribution, you're actually picking up very little income tax. So I don't know. I think there's different ways of arguing that one, to be honest.
Okay. Well, maybe I'm unfair asking you that question, so I'll let that go. I mean, the comment was made that actually, as compared to other countries, we do not actually pay all that much tax here at the moment. Is that something any of you are able to comment on? No.
So what are you focusing on the submissions, John?
Okay. And well, I'll try again. On the administration side of it, we've also been told that other countries would have a variety of income taxes within them, and we understand from last panel that in the United States, for example, now I know PricewaterhouseCoopers are all over the world, so although I accept you don't do the payroll all over the world, I think Switzerland's another example where there are different rates. So I'm just wondering administratively, presumably businesses, international businesses, cope relatively easily with a variety of income tax rates, even within a country and probably around countries. Is the administrative side really such a big problem?
I think there are challenges internationally with administration. I think the United States is an interesting example, because I'm presuming you're referring to the state and the federal and the city position. I think there are some areas, and perhaps when we gave evidence the last time, you remember that we alluded to the situation around the New York metropole as opposed to the Washington DC one, where Washington is driven by residents, New York is driven by where you physically work, and the complications around that, and there have been winners and losers in all of those states around that particular rationale, and there have been challenges with that administration. It's been embedded for a long time. So I think you're right. I think complexity shouldn't be underestimated, because for those individuals who are mobile or who can work across, if you like, Scotland and the rest of the UK, it can bring challenges as well. So there's a lot of legislation behind it in the States. There's equally a lot of legislation behind it in Switzerland and elsewhere. So do not underestimate that. And the other thing I would say is, the onus on the administration, perhaps, is, you know, is it an employer onus or is it an individual onus? Mm-hmm. And I think that actually drives some of the behaviours as well.
So in other countries, would it be more emphasis on the individual employee filling in a tax return, whereas here it's more emphasis on PAYE?
Yes. It in the countries where I'd say it's more complex, the individual has a greater role to play.
Right. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Jackie, to follow by Mark.
We'll hopefully ask you questions you can answer. can I just test, because you're outlining quite a cautious position. We want certainty, of course we all do. We want the system to succeed, to be easily understood. Okay, I get all of that from your perspective. See, when we come to a year's time, are you not likely to be saying the same thing to us? When the Puth-Smith powers confer a more nuanced, perhaps even more complex system available to us? Is this just naturally where your default position would be? Because for employers, for taxpayers, that certainty, that transparency, that bedding down of a system is what you would argue anyway.
I think in a year's time, there will be a greater awareness who of whom is and who is not a Scottish rate of taxpayer. I think there will be an awareness, if you like, for employers and employees as to how it is administered and what it looks like and works with. And then post-Smith, you're right, there could be a more complex tax rate band and taxing mm-hmm. system. But, you know, for me, it's all around how you communicate that and take that forward, given the starting point you will have with the awareness of who is and who isn't a Scottish rate of taxpayer.
I would say that I would much support that, and I think there's perhaps two points to take out from it. One, there's the messaging, and I'm not sure that it's solely the responsibility of HMRC as to who's a Scottish taxpayer, because it ties into accountability, doesn't it, rather than just operational matters, which is where HMRC sits, and there's only so much you can do on the operational side. But once people know who's a Scottish taxpayer, that's fine. On the operational side, you know what big government IT projects are like, and we might always be slightly cautious. We are accountants. But allowing for that, nevertheless, you know, it's a really big undertaking to make payroll to run smoothly, and such a lot of money comes out of it, and I think you need that to run at least once, perhaps, without too much jiggling about with it.
Okay. Yeah. I think the arguments you've just made actually apply when we get to the second range of powers that we're going to get. And it is that natural kind of, I described it as caution, but it's more about making sure systems are right. So let me kind of develop a little bit about what we're told HMRC are doing. So there's a letter to Scottish taxpayers going in December to try and identify that cohort. There's been dialogue between HMRC and employers. I think you said earlier, somebody said guidance wasn't finalised yet. Has there been any slippage to the timetable? Is there anything there that HMRC have been doing or haven't been doing that you would want them to do?
I think the difficulty for HMRC, we had a big meeting with them last week, over 100 mm-hmm. members turned up and a joint discussion group, and it was really helpful. And HMRC have done a lot to come and meet the professions and meet employers. They're doing a great deal with that. I understand from some of the conversations we had that there may be restrictions around budget and who's paying for the budget for advertising all of this. And, you know, I don't know if it's coming out of HMRC pocket or whether it's Scottish Government, but that maybe needs looked at. We were asking them, for instance, if the broader message about who's a Scottish taxpayer might go out through, I don't know, Coronation Street or the Archers or whatever. And no, because there's no budget for that. And I don't know whether that's necessary, but it would definitely help to promote it the way you do on bigger HMRC campaigns. So
I'm sure we could have a word with River City, who are filming their December issues just now, but there you go. Let me push you slightly further on this, because in a passage that has been quoted to us, HMRC's communication of the operational aspects of SRIT and its implications for taxpayers will be linked to the Scottish Government's communication of decisions on the level of the Scottish rate in the Scottish budget. Now, that level is likely to emerge in February. The whole budget process has been delayed as a result of the Chancellor's statement in November, but the consequence of that is there is a short period of time for scrutiny, but nevertheless, we hope to be, I think, setting those decisions out in February. Is that sufficient time in your view, given that they are very much hooking what they now do with what the Scottish Government announces?
Well, from my perspective, two points. I think February is a bit late, given that most of our members seem to be getting a bit twitchy about it now. I think in terms of taxpayers more broadly, it needs to be starting cranking up, ideally, because otherwise it's going to come from nowhere in February. So February to me strikes me as a bit late to start putting the main comms out. On the other hand, I know HMRC have done research into putting the comms out, and what's the point in telling somebody about Scottish rate of income tax if you don't know what the rate is? So I realise that that one's difficult to manage.
Okay. But they were communicating to you that restrictions in budget will mean that they have curtailed their advertising.
I don't know if that's a formal HMRC pitch, but that's certainly where we were with discussions last week.
It's helpful to know. Thank you, convener.
Yeah,
I wondered on a couple of things. First of all, following on from Jackie's points around the publicity around this, I mean, based on the submissions that you've put in, it seems as though there is now a sort of percolation of information to the professionals. But your view would be that there needs to be a wider public awareness of SRIT. And I guess my wonder would be, what is it you think are the messages the public need to hear? Because, you know, the sort of sausage analogy of how much of the process do people really need to know about compared to the end product. So what are the messages that you think the public need to hear, which obviously would be different to what the, you know, the sort of tax advisors, the professional elements would need to know about?
The public would need to know what the Scottish rate of income tax is. They need to know whether they are or are not a Scottish taxpayer. They also need to know what their responsibilities are, so far as being a taxpayer is concerned, and they also need to know how it is going to affect them financially.
Okay, so some of those messages are easier to communicate at an earlier stage, and I guess the question around the sort of the February timescale is really when we'll be consulting on the budget, rather than there being the ability to do some publicity around the mechanics of SRIT. That would be more about how much you're going to pay under SRIT. And obviously there's a question as well, which links into the convener's earlier question about taxpayer behaviour. Because the question is, you know, how early do you pull the rabbit out of the hat in terms of what you're going to be applying the tax rate as? Because obviously at Westminster, you tend to be told at the dispatch box, this is the rate and it will apply, you know, immediately, in many instances, for some taxes certainly. So how early do you think people should be aware of what the tax is going to be, and what's the impact that could have on taxpayer behaviour?
I think perhaps there's a slightly different conversation, because this is new and it's a Scottish rate of income tax. It's just, what is it and why are we going to have it? And even if it's 10p in the pound, do you know, well, if, even more so if it's 10p in the pound, why bother? It's just the same as what we've had before. So, but actually that's not right, is it? Because it's fundamentally different and it gives the Scottish Parliament government its own money. And I think perhaps it's that part of the message that's missing.
Mm-hmm. I agree, I mean, but I think the other point Hazel was making was around how much will people pay, was one of the other messages that needs to be put out there, and that's about the rate that will be applied. Mm-hmm. And I guess my question was, at what point do you feel, you know, there's a tension there about how early do you communicate the rate that you intend to levy, and what impact does that potentially have on taxpayer behaviour for those, you know, if you were going to take the decision to put up the rate, and that could lead to deferral of income and things like that. The longer lead-in period you have from when you announce that rate to when it comes into effect, the more time and opportunity there is for individuals to make those behavioural changes in order to perhaps defer income and avoid paying at that rate.
I think any change of rate, whether it be up or down, has a different admin burden attached to it. So basically there is something that will need to change in the actual payroll mechanism to actually deal with that rate. And generally speaking, to make those changes, you need probably about 3 months to kind of make that kind of change to run through a payroll. At least 3 months is the way. So if you like, from it, not from a driving behaviours point of view, but rather from delivering the payroll, you probably need at least that lead-in time, would be what my thoughts would be.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Gavin?
Thank you. From your discussions with HMRC and stakeholders and clients and so on, I mean, are there any, other than what you've said in your submissions, are there any banana skins out there that could affect the smooth operation of the Scottish rate of income tax that you think this committee ought to be aware of now? Is there anything kind of inside you just kind of nervous? Is there anything you're nervous about, anything that you think ought to be put out there on the table now that this committee should be aware of? For all panellists.
I think there isn't anything outside of what's in those papers. I think for me the main thing is to raise that awareness of who is a Scottish rate of taxpayer and what it actually means. Not necessarily the rates, but get that messaging out earlier. It's almost drip feed the information, because then people take it on board a bit easier, generally speaking. Yeah. So it's be mindful of that. So don't be driven by any rate change up or down or staying flat, whatever you decide to do. Make people aware that it is coming, because I think that is a big step change that probably would be helpful if it happened.
Yeah. The other kind of possible nervousness I would have in operational terms is that HMRC are going to write to everybody who they think is a Scottish taxpayer, and that's fine. But what happens to all those folk who might be Scottish taxpayers who are not written to? And you know, do they have a duty to come back to HMRC and say, oh, you forgot about me? I don't know. And payroll is not driven at the moment off addresses, so there's quite a gap there. There needs to be a sea change in taxpayer mentality as to whether they want to tell HMRC that they're Scottish taxpayers, about telling them when changes of addresses take place. And I'm not sure, Gwyneth, is there a mechanism in place for that as yet? Is there?
It's not clear, Charlotte, from the discussions I've had, that isn't clear at all, that is there. So, and that's why, you know, for me, I think it's important to highlight who is a Scottish taxpayer. And again, like you rightly point out, what if you are a Scottish taxpayer or not, what your obligations are before you even get to the rate.
Okay. No, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Is the release as well, which we haven't really spoken about, for taxpayers who are making donations under the gifted scheme and those making pension contributions, then the relief is to be given at the Scottish rate of income tax. But the systems which are in place at the moment and will be from next April will only give relief at the 20% rate of tax. So there will require to be an adjustment to a taxpayer's liability to give the correct relief overall. We don't know how smoothly that will go.
Okay. I mean, have you raised that with HMRC?
Well, they've said for the moment, well, my understanding is that they are looking at updating systems so that they can give the correct relief, but it may take 2 years to do so. They may accelerate that or give further consideration to it if the Scottish rate of income tax diverges significantly from the UK rate.
Okay, no, that's helpful too. Thank you. Just a couple of our kind of sweep-up questions. We talked a bit about behavioural response, and I think you all indicated that you'd heard, you'd all had anecdotal evidence, but no kind of firm evidence. In terms of this committee, and in terms of the Scottish Government and the Parliament, behavioural responses is not something we've looked at in great detail, and it was pointed out by the Scottish Fiscal Commission that it was a weakness in the Scottish Government, and that it was just a capacity we didn't really have at this stage. If you were advising this committee and the Scottish Government and Parliament as a whole, what sort of capacity do you think we should have in terms of looking at behavioural responses specifically to income tax?
It's quite difficult to judge that one, isn't it?
I think it is very difficult to judge. I think probably depending on where your mind is around the rates, I think there's modelling that people far more intelligent than I could probably help you with. And I think it needs to be, from my point of view, it needs to be probably driven by those facts and figures.
Okay. If I phrase it another way then, from the anecdotal evidence that you have, are we talking about a handful of people that might move to Berwick and therefore you probably wouldn't invest a huge amount in building up your capacity, or do you think it could be potentially a lot wider than that and therefore it is investing in some capacity to try and make sure you get those sums right? What's your kind of gut feel from the anecdotal stuff you have?
Perhaps to take a different analogy, my gut feel is that I wouldn't rely on me, because I didn't think you would have as much behavioural reaction to the LBTT rates last year. I was quite taken aback at what an impact that had. And so I wouldn't like to rely on anything I had to say in behavioural. It is quite strange how people behave in relation to taxes. It's not always predictable.
Okay. Charlotte, you talked about people being a bit, or starting to get a bit twitchy. Obviously, you're involved in some of these stakeholder groups and ways in with HMRC. This guidance that's coming out at the end of this month, I mean, I don't know whether you've seen the guidance or not, but is your view that that might reduce some of the nervousness, or do you think something more than, clearly they will do more than the guidance, but is that going to go some way to reducing it?
There's draft guidance out already, so anybody who's interested in it has had a look at it, and you know, it's there, and you can. It's very helpful. It's a really good start, and you know, we're fine-tuning around the edges. That's grand. I think the twitchiness is more broadly, perhaps amongst those who don't quite have time. You know, the people who say that they've got their day jobs to do without rushing about looking at other guidance or draft guidance, especially perhaps amongst the small and medium enterprises.
Okay. No. And last question, just, I mean, you've been asked about the P60 point already. I mean, the argument has been made that some people want to know the information. The counter-argument is that because it's only likely to be for a couple of years, at some point it becomes redundant when Smith is enacted. But, I mean, just in technical terms, how difficult, obviously there's some work would be required, but how difficult in technical terms would it have been to include that information in the P60? Is it a case of the amount of effort actually didn't justify the end, or could it actually have been done quite easily? Is there an easy answer to that question?
I think software providers were finding it challenging from a payroll admin perspective, so I suspect you thought it was possibly going in the too hard basket is right. And as Charlotte quite rightly says, in a year or 2 years' time, whenever Smith is implemented, things will look different again, and everything will be, you know, coming to the Scottish Government. You know, they will have their own spending power from that. So actually, was it too hard for the two-year period? Probably yes.
Okay, that's good. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Gavin. We don't have any further questions for committee. I'm just wondering if witnesses would like to touch on any points that have perhaps not been covered that you feel you want to mention, or are you happy to let things lie as they are? It's up to you. Great. Well,
thank you.
Well, thank you very much for your time this morning and giving evidence. That's very much appreciated. I'm going to call a 2-minute recess just to allow for a changeover of witnesses.
The next item of business is to take evidence on the Land Reform Scotland Bills, Financial Memorandum from the Scottish Government Bill Team. I'd therefore like to welcome to the meeting Fiona Taylor, Helen Jones, Douglas McLaren and Fiona Leslie. Members have received copies of a briefing note and all written evidence submitted, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. So a very warm welcome to you this morning. We'll try not to be too brutal. Okay, well, first thing I want to touch on is the submission from COSLA. And they've said, and I quote, "A report by Solace has highlighted the potential costs involved in requiring local authorities to register all their land and buildings over the next 5 years. Initial investigation by the Improvement Services estimates that the total cost to Scottish local government is likely to exceed £150 million. And they say that they go on to talk about the cost of preparation includes locating the deeds, accessing market values and providing plans for each title to be registered. So do you have any comments on that?
I think obviously the completion of the land register is a separate part of the wider land reform programme that's not immediately relevant to the bill.
Yeah, yes.
So in terms of any comment on the costs that Solace refer to, that would our ROS colleagues at Register Scotland would be best placed to address that point, and we'd certainly be happy to to get them to feed into the committee if that would be helpful.
Well, I'd appreciate that because I realise it wasn't the financial memorandum, but clearly it's related to it, so therefore it would appreciate it if you did give us some
certainly
further information.
Certainly, we'll take
on
that away.
Instead of what is in the financial memorandum itself, obviously you'll be well aware there are one or two organisations have got specific concerns, and you won't be surprised that I'm going to now touch on the submission from the British Association for Shooting and Conservation, who say, and I quote, "We do not feel that the financial memorandum accurately reflects the cost that will be borne by local authorities with respect to billing, collection, enforcement and determination of rates relief." And they talk about negative unintended consequences of the non-domestic tax rate for shoots. And just to add to that, they say, they talk about the statement on page 73 of the financial memorandum being misleading in part 6, where it says, and I quote, "Application of non-domestic rates to shootings in deer forests to remove the exemption from business rates for shootings in deer forests is in order to help fund local services and to place shootings in deer stockings businesses on a level playing field with other rate-paying businesses." Now, the latter of that might be true, but in terms of funding local services, do they not have a point? Because what they basically go on to say is additional receipts from ratepayers will accrue to local authorities and then go to the Scottish Consolidated Fund. The effect will be a corresponding reduction to general revenue grant, blah blah blah. So basically, you know, the financial memorandum is it not being slightly misleading? We're saying, well, this will go to local services. The implication being that in the area where the shoots are, there'll be additional funding. When in actual fact, it will just go to the Scottish Consolidated Fund for potential redistribution.
I'll pass this across to Dougie McLaren to answer.
thanks. So we have read obviously the BESC's points. So just, I suppose, in reverse order, on the point about where the money goes, the rates revenue does accrue to local authorities. It's pooled via the Scottish Consolidated Fund and then effectively returned to local authorities. So in terms of following the public pound, the rates, this rates revenue goes to the local authorities and will be spent by them. The way that the local government finance settlement is agreed with local government is that the two main components of the revenue settlement are rates revenue and general revenue grant. So if one component, the rates revenue, rises, say by X, then all else being equal, the general revenue grant will that the Scottish Government funds falls by X. So that allows the government, it effectively eases the pressure on the wider Scottish Government budget and allows, you know, other equivalent funding to be directed not to the general revenue grant but to something else. So it's not directly that same money, which because the rates revenue goes to local authority, but the effect it has in the Scottish Government budget enables us to direct equivalent funding to something else. And the First Minister has said the Scottish Land Fund.
I mean, I think everyone around the committee will be fully aware of that process, but I mean, it's not really the same about helping funding local services. I mean, surely it could have been rephrased to make it clear that it
the implication being that it's going to assist in the areas where the money is being raised. I mean, that's clearly the implication, surely, from the financial memorandum, and it's not really the case. I mean, you know, you could be raising it, for example, on the island of Arran, where shooting estates, and the money could be spent in, you know, Aberdeen or Edinburgh or whatever, on something completely different. Is that the case?
Well, I think we've tried to set out factually what happens with the money and the effect it has on the Scottish Government budget. I don't think we've tried to say that the rates revenue itself, in terms of following the public pound, will go to something like the Scottish Land Fund, but it does have an impact on the wider Scottish Government budget because of the local government finance arrangements.
Okay, in terms of sticking with this, the particular issue and the impact on country sports tourism. In their submission, they again say that recent independent research into Scottish country sports tourism revealed that 88% of shooting and stocking providers said that their shoot roughly broke even or ran at a loss. Is there any concern that the removal of this rates relief will have an adverse impact on employment, which is also a concern of the gamekeepers? And perhaps put some of these shoots out of business? Has there been any work done to see whether or not that will or will not be the case?
We'll certainly listen to all the stakeholder evidence. we absolutely accept that taxes can have impacts, and in some cases adverse impacts, on the taxpayers, and that can affect their employment decisions. What it is very hard to do is to model the effects of how a change in property tax affects cumulatively employment decisions, because obviously that will just be one factor in a business's decision. So it would be difficult enough if we knew accurately the rates liability, and because we still have to go through the process where the assessors need to value the tax base. As we've acknowledged, we can't accurately predict that. We can only give a broad estimate at this stage. But even if we were to accurately know the rates revenue, as we do for other sectors that pay not domestic rates, it's very hard to model accurately the effects on employment, such as for rural job losses, because property tax is just one factor in a business's decision. But yeah, absolutely accept that there are impacts.
Negative impacts.
Well, in some cases, yes. I mean, that's tax, I'm afraid. If you pay out money, of course.
Of course, but what would be the positive impacts then? No, I'm not talking about the Scottish Consolidated Fund. I'm talking about to the local communities where this actually will be implemented.
Well, it's a revenue-raising measure. I mean, business rates is obviously a revenue-raising measure. So, as I said, you know, the money will be used to help fund local services. And the indirect benefits, we've said, will allow the government to direct funding elsewhere, such as the Scottish Land Fund.
Okay, then. In terms of a submission from my own local authority, Scottish, in North Ayrshire Council, which I often quote because they always seem to send a submission in to almost every call for evidence, and I wish more local authorities would actually do that. They say, and I quote, the bill will have limited financial consequences for local government. However, in some areas, this is dependent on the definitions applied to key terms within the bill and how these will be implemented. An example of this is within access and core paths, which places a responsibility in local authorities to make reasonable inquiries into land ownership when ownership information is not readily available. So we're going back to what I was kind of saying initially. It started off with inquiries into land ownership can be expensive and the cost implications of the bill, which depend on what ministers define as reasonable. And again, they talk about savings being dependent on the definitions applied to key terms in the bill. So if we actually look at that, is there really been any kind of analysis of what the impact will be on individual local authorities in terms of this?
In terms of the core paths aspect specifically?
Yes.
To address that point, I'll pass that across to Helen initially.
This bit of the bill is about where there are new core paths. At the moment, Scotland has complete coverage of core path plans. Uh-huh. And this is about where a local authority does a review of a core path plan and decides to add in a new core path. And that is a situation in which the local authority would be required to serve notification on the owner. And I think what we would expect is that they would make an inquiry through the Register of Scotland in the first instance. If that proved difficult, the bill envisages that they would put a notification or a notice on the land in question. And it's really just to sort of make the process a little bit more perhaps fair to the landowner, so they know that a core path is proposed across their land. And under the present procedure, there has been very wide consultation with local access authorities, through public events and other people as local authorities may think fit. And we would have hoped that local landowners would have been some of those people. But now this is just making it a bit more explicit. Now, we don't know the costs because we simply don't know which local authorities will make major revisions to their core path plans in the future. It might only be one or two extra paths. We simply don't know. But we will be issuing guidance to local authorities. We already have guidance on the Part 1 of the Land Reform Scotland Act, and we'll update that guidance on this point about, you know, the type of inquiries that need to be made.
And, I mean, obviously you don't know the cost, but have you got any kind of ballpark figures of what you think it could
be?
We don't. Minimum and maximum?
Well, we don't, because we simply don't know how many authorities would, how many paths would they want to add. You know, we can't do crystal ball gazing into that, I'm afraid.
But surely if you're bringing in legislation that's going to have an impact, surely you must have some kind of idea about what kind of impact it's going to have financially on local authorities, especially if the local authorities are going to be expected to pay for these out of existing budgets, as I imagine they will be.
Well, it's interesting when you look at the evidence from the local authorities. Three have said, well, there might be a cost, but we don't really know how much. And one, Sterling, actually says, we can easily subsume this within our existing current service provision. So...
Yes, I mean, obviously, our job is to interrogate with people who have concerns. I mean, if you look at the submission from South Ayrshire Council, they've just put in the word yes to every single question, apart from the last one, which is not anticipated future costs. So, you know, I fully appreciate there's a balance in terms of the submissions, but obviously we have to ask on behalf of those who have particular concerns. And South Lanarkshire is another local authority that does have concerns in terms of being asked whether your organisation can meet any financial costs that might be incurred as a result of the bill. They've said no. In the current climate, there is no spare capacity within the budgets of local authorities to meet any additional burdens as a result of new legislation. So surely, if there is going to be additional burdens, then that imposed by the Scottish Government, it should be funded by the Scottish Government.
Well, let's assume, for example, South Lanarkshire decide to do a review of their core path plan and they decide to put in two or three extra paths. I mean, I'm making this up. I don't know what the plans really are.
Yeah.
If they went to the Registers of Scotland, my understanding is a search is about £20. If they then fail to find the owner, they could then do as the bill suggests and post a notice on the land and do it that way. So it doesn't seem as if the costs would be huge.
Well, that's no doubt why some local authorities have said there will be no financial implications, but obviously there are some who do. Okay, I'll open out the session now to colleagues around the table. Gavin, to be followed by Jackie.
Good morning. In terms of the financial memo, you've set out in pages 74 to 77, you basically got all the charts of what the costs are likely to be. I just wonder, is it possible to get a chart that tells me the total cost of this bill to the Scottish Government, the total cost to local government, and then the total cost to other organisations? Because you've set some of them out individually, but actually I felt I had to do quite a lot of calculating to try and make sure I was getting total cost. I don't need it now specifically, but is that something you either have or can send to the committee? I'd just like to have something in black and white that tells me the total cost of the bill on each of those three.
Yeah, certainly in doing this, we did follow sort of the pro forma for financial memos and filled it in that way. It will be quite difficult to have the model across the different sectors in some places, because obviously with the ranges that we have and some of the areas within the bill, 10 parts of the bill, there are uncertainties there with some of the costs, but we can certainly attempt to put something together if that would be helpful for consideration.
It's just that most financial memos I've dealt with have done what you've done, but then they also give you the cumulative total, and that hasn't happened. I just wonder if that can be done for the sake of completeness.
We can certainly look at supplying that for the committee, yes.
Okay, thank you. Second question then is, one of the aspects in there is the Scottish Land Commission. And in terms of sort of concrete costs that you set out, the running costs of that will be £1.321 million a year. I just want to try and establish, should we view all of that as new and additional costs, or in policy terms, is that replacing some work that is already done and therefore the net cost is not quite as high as £1.3 million, or is that all new work and it's all new
money effectively?
My understanding is that it is in principle new money, yes, sorry, but will be accommodated within existing budgets, yes.
Okay.
This also, I would emphasise that this is very much illustrative at this point, sure, and that we made some assumptions in order to come up with the cost headings to get to the 1.321 million, and that we do have in place now a small project team that's starting to look at the critical milestones going forward when decisions will need to be made in terms of public appointments, and location setup of office and those sort of things. So there may well be some movement between these areas going forward.
Sure, no, I understand that, and it's a best estimate. But I just wanted to be clear: is it's not replacing anything else, or it's not carrying out some functions that government already do, and therefore you could say actually the net cost is a bit less than that. It's all new functions, effectively.
It is all new functions. Okay. Yes.
All right. Thank you. In terms of the convener asked you quite a few questions about the valuation role for shootings in deer forests. Just one comment there. It says you're estimated £4 million subject to rates relief or potential rates relief. Can I just be clear? I mean, is that you just kind of covering all bases, or are there kind of firm policy commitments to create rates reliefs in that area? Because if I think of the main rates reliefs now, it's, you know, charities, small business bonus. It wouldn't, you know, it'd appear that they wouldn't apply, I don't think. Are there rates reliefs you're specifically thinking about, or are there new policy options, or have you just put that phrase in there to kind of cover yourself effectively?
What we're proposing is that the shootings in deer forests would be eligible for the prevailing rates reliefs in the same way as other non-domestic properties. So we're not proposing a new rates relief in this area. I mean, we're open to suggestions, but we're not proposing a new one.
Okay.
We think that quite a few of the smaller scale shootings on farms, for example, would quite likely get small business bonus rates relief.
Okay.
So that's why we set it out that way.
Sure. So you think so, but you've not done the work to work out how many would. Or do you have rough estimates?
Well, this is the crux of the question about valuation and being able to predict revenue, because you know the assessors value the tax base, so that's what this legislation does. It's a valuation provision. So in the absence of valuation of the tax base, the best estimate that we can set out is at the macro level, the 2 million sort of 20 years ago, projecting that forward. I mean, there wasn't much rates relief 20 years ago, so projecting that forward and saying broadly total Scottish rates revenue has doubled, so hence 4 million but subject to rates relief is about the best we can do.
Okay, thank you. Just the last area, you've agreed to look at what the kind of total costs would be of the bill across the three categories: Scottish Government, local government, and then you've got this. We've got the other organisations, businesses, and individuals. I mean, that's standard practice for a financial memo. I just wonder on that third one: is there any way you can just provide a bit more information on that? Because when I look through the sort of 10 or 12 categories, we've got part three is £129.80. For disclosure of information for business, was not clear. Is that a one-off, or could businesses potentially have to do that several times over? You've then got engaging communities, prepare guidance, depends on the scale of ownership. Right to buy, there's a whole host of potential costs, but no numbers. Deer management measures cannot be quantified. Agricultural holdings cannot be quantified. So across most of the boxes, you're basically saying it can't be quantified. Are you outlining what the costs might involve, but with no numbers attached to them? Is there any way of being more specific than that at all?
I think in terms of how we draw up the table across the sectors that you've requested, it is going to look a little bit messy in that respect.
Sure.
Because some of the costs are very much upfront costs and some of them are ongoing and initially might be quite high and then drop off. So there's no exact science to that in that sense. So there are difficulties in doing that across the board and across the 10 parts of the bill.
Mm-hmm.
But we can certainly attempt to do that.
I'm left with a sense of, I've got a bit of a sense of what the costs are going to be to Scottish Government, a bit of a sense of what the costs are being to local government. But when I look at the totality of the boxes for the third option, I'm just with a sense of, you're basically saying it can't be quantified. Sometimes it can be quantified, but are you sort of saying it can't be quantified, but we're pretty sure it's a low number, or is it just a kind of blanket can't be quantified? That's where I'm, struggling a bit with this bill.
I think as we go through, as you go through the financial memo in the different parts, we have explained as best we could, and maybe there are parts in which we could be a bit clearer what sectors the costs may impact and how and when those costs may bite, and maybe that's something would be helpful to clarify for within the third category, what sector specifically we're driving at, or you know, would that be helpful to do that? I don't know.
I suppose what's important to me, I guess, as a parliamentarian, is this: is anyone going to get clobbered by this bill? You know, so sometimes you say it can be quantified, but actually, even if we could quantify it, we could say categorically it's a pretty low number, and so it's kind of minimal impact. Mm-hmm. I guess the most important thing to tease out is: are there potential big losers here, and if so, who? And to what extent that doesn't come through in the financial memo. Now maybe there aren't any, and maybe that's why it doesn't come through, but I would just, I guess, want some security that is the case.
I don't think we think that there are any big losers that we've not readily identified in there, so I'm not sure exactly what else we can provide to give that reassurance to the committee. We think where we have said that things can't really be quantified, that usually the impact will be reasonably minimal. But if there are specific aspects within the financial memo in particular, because obviously there are the 10 parts of the bill, if there are particular areas within the financial memorandum where the committee feels that what we see under that heading is maybe not specific enough in terms of the sector we're identifying or the range that we're giving, then we can certainly try and address that. But we'd have to probably tease that out in a little bit more detail as to the specific parts and what the issues really were, because it's not, as I said before, it's not really an exact science.
Okay, well, I suppose then, just to close it off then, what you have said to the committee here is that you have looked at this in depth, and in your view as a bill team, there are no big losers, and so there are bits you can't quantify, but in your view, in financial terms, you haven't identified any big losers. Is that a fair summary of your position?
That's a fair assessment of our overall position. Yeah. Obviously, where there are potentially bigger losers, you know, we have been a bit more specific in terms of the detail of the impact that we have been able to establish.
Sure. Okay, great. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, just before I let Jackie in, I mean, Standing Order 9.32 says that a financial memorandum which shall set out the best estimates of the administrative compliance and other costs to which the provisions of the bill would give rise, best estimates of timescales over which such costs would be expected to arise, and an indication of the margins of uncertainty in such estimates. Do you actually think that that's been achieved in terms of this bill, this financial memorandum?
I think on the whole...
Because there seems to be a lot of how long is a piece of string thing. I'm not really sure, you know, in terms of this.
I think on the whole we feel, yes, that we have done our very best to try and to meet the standing order requirements. So if there are specific aspects of the financial memo that the committee does have concerns about, then we'd be very keen to address them. Clearly, with a bill as big and disparate as this one, with 10 quite distinct policy areas within it, there may be some inconsistencies within the financial memo as to how much detail is in there. And if there are particular bits that the committee feel that maybe we've not fully addressed the standing order requirement, then we'd be only too happy to look at that and address it.
Yeah, it's just potential elephant traps, I think, is a concern that the committee might have. I mean, you know, for example, the £150 million potential cost to Scottish local government in terms of the improvement service estimate, in terms of registration of land buildings, etc., which I touched on at the start. I mean, I know you're saying that this financial memorandum, I'm not looking at that directly, but it's part of the same kind of bill, and you know, these do have concerns, obviously. You know, if these things aren't really being included in all aspects of it in terms of FM.
Just really to reiterate to the committee, the completion of the land register is very much a separate freestanding project.
Yeah, but it leads on from this,
bill.
Is the point.
Yeah, it is part of a wider programme, and we're very much happy to come back to the committee and address the Solace point, but it wouldn't be appropriate to address that point within the financial memo and provide the costs for the completion of the land register, because the financial memorandum is very much about what is contained within the bill, and there are no provisions in the bill that directly impact or facilitate in any way the completion of the land register.
Okay. Well, Causal might disagree on that. Jackie?
Yeah, just to agree with you, Convener, I think that information would certainly be helpful. Obviously, there's been clear concern expressed by the Scottish Gamekeepers Association and also by the British Association for Shooting and Conservation. Not normally organisations I have much to deal with, I have to confess, but actually they raise serious points about the robustness of the estimates. Now, I heard your discussion with the convener about what you do in terms of, you know, the data you have is 1994. You've just simply rolled it forward, doubled it, based on what's happened elsewhere. The Scottish Government's first estimate, apparently, was £7 million. So I'm curious as to where that came from and what happened when that first estimate was given and now that it's at £4 million. So that's the first question. Second question is, accepting that estimates aren't going to be absolutely accurate, what happens if you've got this badly wrong?
Okay, on the first question, as far as I'm aware, we didn't estimate £7 million. I think that was inferred by some stakeholders due to wider comments about increasing the or the rates revenue, enabling funding to be directed to help increase the Scottish land fund from 3 to 10 million. I don't think we said that that 7 million would come from rates revenue. So I suspect that's where some stakeholders may have inferred the 7 million figure from. Because as I understand it, there was a proposal from ministers to increase the Scottish land fund from 3 million to 10 million. Mm-hmm. But ministers had said that the increased rates revenue would help enable that increase from 3 to 10 million. So I think some stakeholders may have inferred that 7 million was going to come from the additional rates revenue, which we haven't said. So hopefully that clarifies.
Can I just press you again on that? So where is the balance coming from?
Well, that's part of the kind of budget decision and part of the budget process to find that from within the Scottish Government's budget and how it chooses to allocate its funds. On your second point, as the committee probably knows, I mean, most non-domestic rates legislation is either valuation or legislation or rating legislation. So this is valuation legislation that we're proposing in the bill to value, you know, for the assessors to value the tax base and record it in the roll. The bill doesn't provide for the rating. It's other existing legislation. I think section 7 of the 1975 Local Government Scotland Act. And then ahead of implementation in 2017-18, ministers will have information from the assessors on the emerging valuations of the shootings in deer forests, and they take that into account when they set the poundage. And they at that stage have options. So your question about what happens if it's wrong, this bill is only part of the equation. It just values the tax base and gets that recorded in the valuation roll. Ministers will, once that has been done, or certainly once the draft valuations have started to emerge, then we'll have a clearer idea of the tax base, and ministers have an option in terms of setting the poundage, and as Mr. Brown said, whether a new rates relief scheme, for example, would be appropriate.
Okay. So there's nothing that you can offer by way of assurance to people now that there is any evidence that you could have brought to bear, bar what happened in 1994, 20 years ago?
The assessors are asked by legislation to obviously go out and do that job, and valuing non-domestic properties can be quite complex, and certainly in other instances it's more complex than shootings in deer forests. So for us to try to do a kind of a proxy exercise now, I think would be very difficult, because I mean, I think there's probably thousands of possible entries out there. The assessors would have to identify these, decide in the valuation methodology, and then value them. If anything that we try to do at this stage could compromise the independence of the assessors, but it could also be problematic if we came to a value that was lower than the assessors subsequently formally went on to make, and it could be cited in appeal hearings. So I think what we've tried to do is just give the best estimate. We've cited our evidence sources. If anybody has other proposals, of course we'll look at them. Some stakeholders have called for better and more robust estimates, but I'm not aware of any actual proposals as to do that.
Final question, Convener, and I don't know whether it's appropriate for the witnesses before us, but let me ask anyway. There have been a number of claims made about the loss of jobs. I don't know whether they're real or not. Has an economic impact assessment actually been completed on this?
We've we've published a business and regulatory impact assessment, a BREIA, but I think, as I was saying in remarks earlier to the convener, it's very difficult, even with knowing the revenue from a property tax, to model and analyse the effects that has on jobs. So, like I say, we accept the point that stakeholders are making, and we'll certainly assess the evidence, and we take a judgment as to whether the new reintroduced rates liability is sustainable. But clearly, as I said, you know, this bill is only one part of the equation. Ministers will have options that will actually set the tax liability further down the line, and including the non-domestic rate order, so which goes through Parliament. Yeah.
Thank you.
Jean?
Convener, to Jackie Bailey's question. The final paragraph in the BASC highlights in that respect the recent independent research. Is that something that you've had access to, or is that something that they have made public?
I'm not sure.
Which is all about the job losses in shooting estates and the fact that some of them run at a loss currently.
We certainly read the PASEC, the PAC EC reports, and they're very informative, and you know, certainly take them into account. But again, they can only help us so far understand and judge the effects that a rating liability would have on the sector.
No, that's fine. I just wondered if they had been made available, and if they were available, if they're in the public domain.
I mean, I think the PASEC reports are published. I've certainly seen numerous PASEC reports, which I think include that one here.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Dad, you say that you take these reports into account. To what degree? I mean, has there been any change in terms of the policy following receipt of that? So how has it been taken into account?
Okay, well, in government, so I'm in the local government finance unit, so I'll work closely with wildlife management colleagues who work closely with the deer with the deer management sector. But because, like I say, this is hard to analyse the effects quantitatively, it becomes more of a qualitative assessment and a judgment, and you know, in dialogue with the industry. So, but a big important step in being able to understand that call is getting the tax base valued, and that's what this bill does. Now, as things currently stand, and all else being equal, other legislation then starts to bite once these things are on the valuation rule come 2017. But like I say, ministers have options, so there'll be a kind of a better appraisal and assessment once the tax base is valued.
Okay, that's clear. Thanks very much for that. That appears to have concluded questions from the committee. Are there any further points the bill team would like to make before we wind up this session? Okay, well, thank you very much for your contributions. Very much appreciated. Thank you. That being the last item on our agenda, I'd now like to call the committee to a close. Thank you very much for your contributions.